one, say something. You can tell that. I think I'm back, but I'm home. Can't really complain when it's like that show.
But when I live, it's in the live.
We got that house in hell. Next time I'm not trying to ride. As long as I stay trusting, I'm going to try it.
Athletics.com.
He's 30-yard line, makes another man miss. Rich Kevin. Big fall, fires, it's kicked. It's in the air, it's caught by Hastings. Hello! Hastings with the amazing catch.
Now let's head out to the stadium for the green and gold kickoff show.
Good afternoon from Gettysburg, Pennsylvania, and welcome to McDaniel Green Terror Football on McDanielAthletics.com. Today at Centennial Conference football action as the Green Terror visit the Gettysburg Bullets here at Shirk Field at Musselman Stadium. Welcome to our webcast, everyone. Together with Jeff Arnold, I'm Charlie Beckhardt. The Gettysburg Bullets off to a 2-2 start. They're 2-1 in the Centennial Conference. The Green Terror, losers of three straight, stand at 1-3 overall and 0-3 in the Centennial Conference. We're glad that you're with us this afternoon. Game time temperature will be in the low 60s. Some sunshine beginning to get out on the artificial turf field here at Shirk Field at Musselman Stadium as we prepare for Centennial Conference action this afternoon. And the Green Terror coming off a loss to Ursinus 42-13 last Saturday. Sophomore quarterback Matty Callahan threw for 239 yards in his first significant action this season. Senior wide receiver Mike Oliveto caught seven passes for 84 yards. Freshman running back John Chamberlain ran for his first two collegiate touchdowns. And on defense, sophomore defensive back Tyler Krebs and junior defensive lineman Eddie Kendall led the defense with seven tackles apiece. But it was an uphill battle again for the Green Terror as the Ursinus Bears rushed for 260 yards and scored the first 35 points of the game. Their sophomore running back Corey Kelly rushed 24 times for 145 yards and a score. And Jeff Arnold, that seems to be the MO of the Green Terror offensive struggles this season is that they fall behind early in the ball game. Points have been scarce in the first half of the ball game. They're not running the football particularly well and are passing the football okay, but it's out of necessity.
Yeah, it really is. And they're going to go with a new quarterback today in Matty Callahan, who got some time last week. Seth McFall got the start against Ursinus. It was really ineffective through the first half, so what they decided to do is they put Callahan in the ball game. And what you add with Callahan is you have somebody that's a little bit more accurate passing-wise. At least he really showed that in the second half of last week's game. But the other thing he brings is a running element, and McDaniel somehow has to get a ground game going. Looks like from what they were practicing in warm-ups, they're going to go with a little bit more of an option type of a look this week and let Callahan use his legs a little bit. And that's going to be a challenge against Gettysburg because they're one of the top rushing defenses in all of the Centennial Conference. But still, you have to find some type of a ground game so that way it can make the play action a little bit more effective and you can find guys like Emilian Oliveto a little easier.
The Bullets only allowing 2.8 yards per carry against the run this season, while the Green Terror are only averaging about 84 yards per game with their rushing attack. Again, they've been forced to the air, as they've trailed every ball game by at least three scores at the half. They got a come-from-behind and thrilling season-opening victory at Catholic, but it's been an offensive struggle since that point. Now, for the Gettysburg Bullets, they even their record at 2-2 with a 31-21 victory over Susquehanna last Saturday. The tie score 14-14 coming out of halftime, and then linebacker Chris Miller intercepted a pass in Crusader territory, and junior tailback Kyle Wigley followed up a 7-yard touchdown run to give the Bullets the lead for good. Senior Nick Ulassen polished off the win with his second rushing score of the game with 4 minutes to go. Gettysburg posting a season-high 323 yards rushing. And as you just alluded to, Jeff, they held Susquehanna to just 72 net yards. So when you can run the football and when you can hold down the opposition's rushing attack, it's a recipe for a win. And Gettysburg is now at 2-2.
They are 2-2. This is a big game for them because they'll have a bye week next week, and after that, they'll take on Muhlenberg and Johns Hopkins, two of the top teams in the Centennial. So this is important for them to see if they can pick up an additional win today. Zach Miller, he's kind of been up and down the last couple of weeks, as the quarterback, so he'll try and get things started. Meanwhile, though, they've gotten great production out of their tailback. Kyle Wigley had 150 yards rushing last week. That was a season high.
This will be the 68th meeting all time between Gettysburg and McDaniel, and it's been pretty one-sided, with the Bullets winning 48 of those contests, the Green Terror 18, there's been one tie. Also an important stretch of the season coming up for McDaniel. This has turned the corner week for the Green Terror, as they are 1-3 after their first four games, and those four opponents have combined for a 12-3 overall record. So a tough stretch to begin the season. Over the next five games, the Green Terror will see whether they're able to declare some progress in this 2014 football season. They're on the road at Gettysburg this afternoon, the Green Terror and the Bullets coming up with a 1 o'clock kick. Up next, Luke Stilson spent some time with McDaniel's third-year head coach, Mike Hoyt, and we'll visit with those two gentlemen when we continue with more of the Green and Gold Kickoff Show live on McDanielAthletics.com.
NCAA Division III and the Special Olympics have partnered to improve the lives of Special Olympic athletes. This initiative is focused upon the involvement of Division III student athletes through service and support of the Special Olympics. To learn more about the partnership, go to NCAA.
We continue here on the Green and Gold Kickoff Show. Here as we get ready for McDaniel and Gettysburg. Here on McDanielAthletics.com, Sports Information Director Luke Stilson, joined as always by Head Coach Mike Hoyt. Mike, thanks for the time.
Thank you.
Back to last week against your Sinus. I guess the end of that week, the top two defenses in the league back-to-back weeks, kind of through that stretch now, and just kind of learned the last 2 weeks against defense, but that was two top defenses in the league, and what we've seen the week and how that's prepared you now it's going forward to this next stretch.
Yeah, we definitely have been through a real tough stretch in our schedule. First four games that we played, all four of those teams have winning records right now. So we knew that this was going to be a tough stretch of the schedule, and particularly the last two were the best two teams, and they're both known for defense, and they showed that. But it's been good for us. I felt that if we could come through this stretch healthy, we would have an opportunity over the next, four or five games to learn from that tough schedule, and hopefully prepare us for some of these next opponents.
Let's talk a little bit about that Sinus game. Started off, defense played well the first couple drives, and then the block punt gave Sinus that short field, and they took advantage of that short field right away. And that kind of really, I guess, probably the momentum shift in that game, really, right there.
Yeah, it shifted the momentum, but I think the other thing was our defense was on the field a lot.
Right. Yeah.
With our offense not able to generate anything and keep drives going, I guess looking at it in a positive light, Ursinus didn't, kill us on big plays. We forced them to march the ball down the field.
Yeah, it's really only 156-yard touchdown. Yeah. That's really one big play they had.
Yep. And, defensively, we're getting better every week. There's no doubt about it. As you watch the film and you study it, we're getting better in terms of our assignments, better in terms of our fundamentals and techniques and stuff. So it was encouraging that, the tough part of it is our defense was out there a lot during the day. And, when you play a big physical opponent like Ursinus, they're going to wear you down over time. And I think that played a big factor.
Yeah, let's start, Ursinus being out there on defense, our defense being out there, and offense didn't really get anything going, you mentioned. First, you guys make the switch and go to Maddie at quarterback. Talk about what you kind of saw from him as he got some game experience last week and now we'll start this week.
Yeah, he did some good things as the game, as he got in there and managed the game and made some decent throws and things like that. We ran the ball with him a little bit more because he's got some athletic ability, so. That allowed us to focus on some of the more quarterback-oriented run plays that we have. So he did some good things. And I think I said last week after the game, we just needed to change something. We had done the same thing again and again and again and hadn't experienced any success. And, nothing against Seth. It's just I felt we needed to change something and do something different. And that was the big reason for the change. And then, Maddie did some good things. So we continued to work with that this week, and we'll see what happens today.
Any advantage, I guess, maybe with Maddie kind of going in knowing to start of the day, you know, instead of being thrown into the situation where, you know, maybe a little wide-eyed getting in there in the second quarter last week?
Yeah, I definitely think that, that'll be to his advantage, having had some time last week. And, he played in all our JV games last year, played in two of the JV games this year. So he has now been game tested and had that experience. So that should hopefully manage his nerves a little bit. Anytime you got a young guy like that that's a sophomore, you know, you always worry about that. But you know, he's a competitor.
Right.
You know, he had a great high school career and played in big games in high school. So I think he'll manage that very, very well. I'm excited for him.
Obviously, one of the things, even over the last couple of years, we've always said, this is the team that's not really, that's never given up. It's the character counts model you've gone back to time and time again. Really, as the game went on, offense kind of found a little more stride. Put a couple big long drives together in the fourth quarter, and then John Chamberlain getting his first couple touchdown runs for short distances.
Yeah, you know, John did a great job. And, you know, the thing that we focused on this week, I talked to the players in our meeting on Monday when we got back together, and talked to him at the end of the game about it, was just continue to be positive, you know, and stress to our staff to continue to be positive and just keep coaching. Just keep coaching them hard and working on our technique and fundamentals. And, because we've got a lot of youth and, we just need to be energetic with them and let them know that we still believe in them.
Right.
We've had a good week of practice because we've been positive and staying after them. So I'm excited to see what happens today.
Another one, another running back kind of got some run there in the fourth quarter. Saw some time from Nick Bianco backfield. Just took a little kind of stuff from him when he got a chance to see him in action and this week.
Yeah, he's another guy that has flashed in the JV games that we've played, and we got him an opportunity to touch the ball and showed some of the same quickness and speed that he showed in the JV games and ripped off a couple nice runs there. So it's exciting to see him produce when he had the opportunity.
Let's flip over to the defensive side of the ball. We talked last week about the defensive line kind of being the hardest working group on hardest working unit as a whole. But then they went up against a really physical Versailles offensive line. But kind of where they're at this week after kind of getting maybe beat up a little bit last week.
Yeah, this week, they're going to have a different challenge. Gettysburg's offensive line is very athletic, where Versailles was a big bruising, run right at you style offense in their offensive line. They pounded on our young guys pretty good, all day long. But I think that's going to be a positive going into this week against Gettysburg. Gettysburg is going to be more athletic. They're going to be more apt to cut us and do some of those types of things instead of line up and just kind of bully us around. So I think having played against actually Muhlenberg and Versailles both, that style of play, I think that's going to help our D-line against Gettysburg be a little bit more. We should, I would hope, have the upper hand when it comes to just physical play.
Also on defense, we've seen some other young guys kind of step up. Jake Fernandez is one who kind of got a chance to play more. See more and more of him now. What have you seen from him this
week? Yeah, we've been giving him a little bit more time each week, and every time we put him in, he does good things. He's got a great nose for the ball. He does a great job reading his keys. When he has opportunities to make plays, he does. And so when young guys do that, you give them more opportunities, and he just continues to grow. And, the more he continues to play, the better he's going to get. And, I'm excited for him, throughout the rest of the season.
He's part of a really young, obviously young team in general, but really young in the linebacking court. Jake's a freshman and gets more time. Obviously, Drew Scott's a freshman. He's showing what he can do. Yep. Richard Settle, I know, is another freshman. You guys have been very high. I haven't seen him in action yet, but there's three freshman linebackers there.
Yeah. Those three, we talked them. And the coaching staff, we refer to them as the three musketeers. And actually, Richard will be active today. Right. He's finally coming off that ankle injury that he's had. How much time we actually give him today, we'll see. But as that ankle continues to improve, he'll play more and more for us. And he's another guy that, to me, I think, if he would have been healthy early, might have been like Drew Scott, a guy that would be a starter for us. You never know.
Let's as we shift gears into Gettysburg a little bit, one thing you mentioned post game last week was not just the physical toll of the last 2 weeks, but the mental toll. Seeing the team respond well from that mental bruising they've taken the last 2 weeks.
Yeah, that was my biggest concern at the end of last week. Was, you know, obviously it took a physical toll, but I figured that through our strength program and the stuff we do in the weight room, I knew that, you know, physically I think we'd bounce back. I was more worried about the mental toll and the emotional toll that those types of teams and games take on you. But, you know, I told the staff Sunday morning when we met, we got to continue to be positive. We got to continue to be upbeat and keep things in perspective. You know, so often sometimes you come through a stretch like this and you don't keep perspective on it. You think, man, we're really not that good. And that's not the case. We played some good football teams.
Yeah.
And so I was honest with the team on Monday. I told them the exact same thing, that let's keep things in perspective. We came through a stretch, you know, definitely, in my opinion, the toughest stretch of the season that we'll have. You got to continue to stay positive and upbeat and just keep working on the things we're doing, because we are seeing improvement. Sometimes it's tough to, when you play really good teams like that, you look at the scoreboard and you say, you know, we're not getting any better, but that's not the case. We are getting better. It's just a matter of us keeping it in perspective, staying positive as a coaching staff, and keep working at it. And they bounced back, had a great week of practice this week. I think this is as good a week we've had, you know, in preparation.
I think earlier in the week we heard the story about the, you know, the freshman coming off the Muhlenberg. You're like, hey, you know, we scored 10 points these guys. I think they've started to keep the perspective as well in that sense.
Yeah, no doubt. You know, they are a very upbeat group. They're, and I think that's one of the great things about youth. Sometimes, you know, we take for granted, you know, or we think, you know, as coaches, it may take more of a toll on us because we're older, and, you know, that type of stuff kind of wears you down at times. But, you know, I think that's one of the benefits of being young. You bounce back. You know, physically and mentally and emotionally as well when you're young. So,
fast forward here, I head to Gettysburg. Head coach Mike Quake joining me as part of the Green and Gold Kickoff Show here on McDanielAthletics.com. I saw Chris Furman Thursday before you guys headed out to practice, and he said that he was really excited about some of the schemes that Coach Daly's put in for the defense this week to counter Gettysburg's option attack. Obviously, you know, they're going to be running team. You know, they run that option out of that. Sort of wing, spread wing, I guess they call their offense. Yeah. And a little bit about what, you know, especially their offense and the defensive counters.
Yeah, well, they're definitely, I think, maybe the best offensive team we'll see all year. Traditionally, year in and year out, they're putting up more points than anybody in the conference. Barry and Kevin, yeah, they do a great job of coaching that system up there. And we're going to have to be on top of it today. It's not all that complicated, but it they run it very effectively. You know, Barry's been there for I think 35 years now, so the guy knows what he's doing. There's no doubt about it. You know, one of the things that we've talked about all week from our standpoint, obviously we're doing a few new things defensively to try to slow them down. You always get concerned about, you know, when you put some new things in, especially with young players. You know, you've got a balance between you know, doing some things scheme wise to help yourself out, but not doing so much that with young guys they don't understand it,
right,
and then they're not in position and you have issues that way. So, you know, my approach, and obviously Coach Day is a great football coach and he's doing some real good things, but the other thing that I stressed to our staff was the best defense is keep them on the sideline.
Right.
So offensively, we've got to have I told our offense, we've got to carry the day. We've got to run the ball. We've got to grind the clock. We've got to shorten the game because their offense, they're going to want to get 100 plays per game offensively. And we want to limit the number of plays they're on the field. So offense, we want to run the ball, grind the clock. You know, when we throw the ball, it's a controlled passing game. Keep the chains moving. Keep the clock moving. We can't be three and out this week and let them get right back on the field. And then defensively, when we get them in third down situations, we got to get off the field. So, you know, the best way to defend them is keep them right over there sitting on the sideline.
I think that's one thing I can mention about that third down conversion. It's not, the offense has had great success on third down, but when they have had success on third down, it's kept drive going, and it's usually resulted in points.
Yeah. Yeah, that's the thing, that if we convert third downs, we'll be okay on offense.
Head Coach Mike Hoyt, my guest on the Green and Gold Kickoff Show. Get you back to Charlie and Jeff. They'll get you set for kickoff right here on McDanielAthletics.com.
Do you know what the McDaniel College community calls the youngest person ever to argue before the Supreme Court? A news anchor and TV host? A wildlife conservationist? Cutting-edge biomedical researcher? Video game designer? Hollywood producer? Best-selling author? And winners of an Emmy and a Pulitzer Prize? We call them alumni. No wonder our alumni achieve greatness. A top-tier liberal arts college that changes lives, McDaniel College offers each student a customized and personal liberal arts education supported by faculty-staff collaboration with leadership and service opportunities. McDaniel is the best bang for the buck, according to Washington Monthly, and recognized as the best value by Kiplinger's Personal Finance. Come see for yourself. Check out Mick Live, our online calendar, at McDaniel.edu for upcoming events, performances, exhibitions, lectures, and more that are free and open to the public. Again, to learn more, visit McDaniel.edu or call 410-857-2230 to schedule a campus visit.
McDaniel visiting Gettysburg this afternoon. The Bullets take the field here at Shirk Field at Musselman Stadium as we welcome you back to more of the Green and Gold Kickoff Show together with Jeff Arnold. This is Charlie Beckhardt. A full slate of Centennial Conference games this afternoon, including the game for the Conestoga Wagon Trophy as Franklin and Marshall visits Dickinson in Carlisle today, the 104th meeting all time. And in that game, Franklin and Marshall will be looking to win for the 600th time in their program history. Also today, it's Muhlenberg at Susquehanna and Moravian at Ursinus, all of them 1 o'clock kickoffs. Juniata is at Johns Hopkins at Homewood Field in Baltimore this afternoon. They started early at 12 noon, and with 8 minutes remaining in the second quarter, Hopkins is out to a 21-7 lead over the Eagles. Hopkins rated number 10 in the nation this week. They lead the all-time series 7-1 against Juniata. This is the 11th time that Hopkins has appeared in the AFCA top 10. They are number 10 entering play today. The captain's meeting at midfield. Gettysburg will take the field with orange jerseys, blue numerals outlined in white, orange helmets with white and blue stripes, and solid blue pants. The green tear in white jerseys with green trim, green numerals, and solid green pants. And the captains, Brandon Jones and Mike Olivetto of the Green Tear, and Zach Miller, Gordon Prince, Cody McNamara, Michael Reale, and Steve Pondo Voigt meet at midfield. Gettysburg's won the toss. And as you hear, the Bullets will get the football first. So we're just moments away from kickoff. 2-2 Gettysburg hosting 1-3 McDaniel this afternoon. And it is time to find out if they can find some answers on offense, Jeff, the Green Terror I'm talking about, because the slow start has been such a visible problem through the first four games.
Yeah, especially because 47 of the club's 64 points, this is McDaniel, have been scored in the fourth quarter, and a lot of those have come during garbage time. You've got to establish some type of a run offense early on against a Gettysburg defensive club that is second in the Centennial in rush defense. Now we'll have to see what type of an impact that Matty Callahan can have as a quarterback that'll run a little bit of option and hopefully provide some type of a ground attack and maybe show Gettysburg a different look.
McDaniel's head coach is Mike Hoyt in his third season, 3-21 thus far with the Green Tear, and the veteran Barry Streeter in his 36th season heading the Gettysburg Bullets program, the most among D3 active coaches, 36 years, a 506 winning percentage, 180 wins, 172 defeats, and 5 ties. He is tied for the 7th most wins among active Division III coaches. The Green Tear to kick off first today. We'll take a quick look at the Bullets offense, which features quarterback Zach Miller, 61 of 107 this season. The Bullets passing game, a 57% completion ratio. Miller's thrown for 751 yards, 5 touchdowns, and 4 interceptions. They call it the spread wing offense that we'll see from the Bullets this afternoon. It is a fast-paced offense, so the Green Tear will try to slow that down and see if they can't be in a ball game by halftime. They came from behind at Catholic to win late, but in the next 3 contests found themselves down substantially, and there was no comeback forthcoming. So for McDaniel,
Mike Casper has it teed up.
Kicking team, 5 yard penalty. Kickoff.
Well, Jeff, I've been doing this for a long time, and I cannot say I've ever seen a delay of game on the opening kickoff.
That's absolutely bizarre, Charlie, and I'm with you. I have not personally seen it either, but it means that McDaniel will now have to kick off from the 30 rather than the 35-yard line, and I don't know, let's just hope that that first penalty on the opening kickoff isn't an indicator for how things are going to go today.
So now we hear a whistle. McDaniel heard the whistle, and Casper will right foot it downfield. A spinning kick backs up to the 2 yard line. On the return, Gettysburg stumbles across the 30 to the 35 out to the 39 yard line. The ball squirts free, but the runner was down. As on the return, Nick Ulassen brings it out 37 yards, and the Bullets will have it first at their 38 yard line, just underway in Gettysburg.
It was still a good kick, but Ulassen was able to find a little bit of a convoy and some space and a good opening kick and good field position for the Bullets, who really haven't needed a whole lot of help over the first couple of weeks.
So they'll show the spread on this first and 10 play from their 38-yard line, the handoff between the tackles, not much there. We'll call it no gain as Kyle Wigley, a tailback who's averaging 6.1 yards per carry, is stopped for no gain, second and 10. Now on the toss to the right, coming to the near sideline, out across the 40 and into McDaniel territory to the 46-yard line. Travis Andrews has picked up a Gettysburg first down.
And they'll get the wings involved in the rushing attack there. It was Andrews who had 4 carries last week, so you've got Wigley, Andrews, Caruso, and McCarthy as well, a number of guys that can run the ball.
From a slot right formation, this is Wigley, takes a hit behind the line of scrimmage in a second effort. We'll get him inside the McDaniel 45-yard line, down to the 43. The gain will be 3. Whistle stopped the clock in the first minute of play. This is Gettysburg's first possession of the game. And an officials' conference here with the ball positioned at the McDaniel 43-yard line.
Offside, defense, number 51, 5-yard penalty, repeat, first down.
So that play won't count as, again, some strange happenings early on regarding penalty calls. They ran the entire play and no one heard the whistle. And so it's a 5-yard penalty against the Green Terror, who find themselves facing a 1st and 5, and the swing pass intended for Andrews is off his outstretched hand near the 40-yard line and incomplete to bring up a 2nd and 5.
That was sort of a little bit behind Andrews, and Miller's a guy that is very accurate. He's 2nd in program history in completion percentage, 61.5.
They'll give it to Wigley, and he slips down just inside the 40-yard line in the middle of the field. Wigley looking to make a cut. It rained overnight. This is an artificial turf field. It doesn't seem like the footing is anything less than good, but Wigley there did lose his balance a little bit and tackled himself. It's 3rd down and 4. Toss back goes to Wigley, running it into the near side of the field, and he's escorted out of bounds, shy of the 35-yard line of McDaniel. Very close to a first down, and they will give Wigley and the Bullets offense their 2nd first down of the drive. So with 13:23 to play in the opening quarter, Bullets have the ball first and penetrating into McDaniel territory, a play fake, and now Miller's going to take off, has some room along the near sideline, and is undercut inside the 25-yard line there for the McDaniel tackle. Was Dan Traynor, a junior defensive back out of Brick, New Jersey.
And when you're a Gettysburg offense that's got so many moving pieces, sometimes you forget about Zach Miller. He had 77 yards rushing last week.
It's 1st down. The handoff goes inside, and inside the 20-yard line, Wigley gets wrapped up after a gain of about 5. Traynor getting the start at defensive back together with Akil Tweedy at cornerback
for McDaniel this afternoon. Here's a play fake, and a pop pass is caught for a Gettysburg touchdown. From 19 yards out, the connection goes to Fred Caruso, the wing back out of the backfield, and nice touch on the pass from Miller.
This defense, number 51, penalty is declined. Result of play, touchdown.
So McDaniel flagged for three penalties on that drive, and of course Gettysburg wants no part of that one on a 19-yard reception from Caruso, who's leading the conference in all-purpose yards. And on their first drive, Gettysburg is on board. The extra point attempt by Garrett Long is up and through, and with 12:35 to play in the opening frame, it's a bullet seven and the Terror nothing here on McDanielAthletics.com.
Now open an all-new McDaniel Athletics online store. The new store features t-shirts, sweatshirts, polos, hats, shorts, sweatpants, anything you might want to support your favorite Green Terror team. Check it out online at shop.mcdanielathletics.com.
Fred Caruso with his 13th reception of the season and his first receiving touchdown. In fact, his first touchdown of the year. And the Bullets out to a 7-0 lead over McDaniel with 12:35 to go in the first quarter. Charlie Beckhart joined by Jeff Arnold on McDanielAthletics.com. The drive goes 62 yards. And they went to the air twice. Miller misfired a little bit on a flat pass, but had touch and was right on target to Caruso, who was wide open for the score.
And now this becomes the part where McDaniel has to try and answer. We mentioned it off the top. 47 of the 64 points scored this year by the Green Terror have come in the fourth quarter. They can't do what they did last week against Ursinus, where they found themselves in a 21-0 hole at halftime.
The Bullets bunch up in a pair of huddles as Long sends it downfield with a left foot. A ground ball kick will be picked up off the turf at the 16-yard line by Sean Montgomery, and Montgomery is brought down from behind as he crosses the 25-yard line. They'll mark it down at the 26, and that's where the Green Terror will bring the offense out for the first time today, led by sophomore quarterback Matty Callahan, getting his first collegiate start. He's 23 out of 43 with 301 passing yards, one touchdown, and three picks. Touchdown throw went 2 weeks ago late in the ball game against Muhlenberg, the home opener for the Green Terror. And Callahan passed for 239 yards last week. He did not start in that ball game, but saw the most action. Shotgun snap from the pistol. And the handoff goes to Tayod Campbell. The Green Terror go to the ground on their first play. Just a couple there for the freshman. And it'll be second down and a long nine.
And last week, Mike Hoyt was saying that with Callahan, you know, you bring him in the middle of a game, that's always difficult. He thinks that even though he's starting, you know, there'll be some pressure considering it's Gettysburg, but he thinks he'll be able to handle it well.
Callahan has Campbell at his left. The handoff goes to Campbell. Better running room this time as he slashes off the right side out across the 30 up to the 32-yard line. Tayod Campbell, a freshman, entering play with 221 yards on 44 carries, a 5 yards per carry average. And it'll be third down and three for the Green Terror at their 33-yard line. The Terror moving right to left before us across the artificial turf surface of Shirk Field at Musselman Stadium. It was Musselman Stadium since the 60s, and then when the artificial surface went in, it became Shirk Field at Musselman Stadium. So you know who the biggest contributor was. Callahan to throw. A wobbler is caught at the 39-yard line. That's Nick O'Melia, the fifth-year senior, and the Green Terror will move the chains.
And that was a great job by O'Melia to adjust because that ball was deflected at the line of scrimmage, and O'Melia came back to retrieve it, got up to the 39-yard line. And so it took a couple of drives last week for McDaniel to get their initial first down, but here they've got it at the 39.
So McDaniel picked up their first down.
Four receiver package. Campbell the running back. Callahan fakes it to Campbell. Throws to Amelia. A wide receiver screen, little bubble screen, up to about the 43-yard line along the near side of the field. So they advance the ball about 5 yards and make it second down and five. Two catches in a row for Amelia.
And Amelia, the only player on this McDaniel roster, was a member of this Green Terror team when the club last beat Gettysburg. You have to go all the way back to 2010, double overtime win.
Amelia, with his 16th and 17th receptions of the season on this drive, the first offensive possession for the Green Tear. Now a swing pass to Oliveto will pick up a first down and more. He spins into Gettysburg territory and surges to the 35-yard line. They went to the far side of the field, the wide side, and Callahan on target for Oliveto, and Oliveto, what, 12, maybe 15 yards after the catch?
And they've tried a couple of these bubble screens early on, and they've worked out well. Oliveto getting a nice block on the perimeter, able to take it up to the 35-yard line. First half last week, we saw McDaniel try a number of long passes downfield. It seems like these quick hitters are working a little bit better, and they also seem to be the calling card of Matty Callahan.
So the Terror have the ball at the Gettysburg 35-yard line, trying to answer a Gettysburg score on their first possession. A ball is tipped again. Callahan going to his right with it, and it looks like Gettysburg's A.J. Hill, a senior defensive end out of Connecticut, got his left hand on it and deflects it incomplete.
You have to watch out for Hill. He's been a McDaniel killer in the past. He had a career-high 10 tackles last week, and as Mike White said in our pregame, this is a Gettysburg defensive line, and it's an offensive line, too, that is very athletic. They've gotten some pressure and clogged up the passing lanes.
The head linesman stops the clock, and the side judge and referee will consult.
Please reset the game clock to 9:26. Clock will start on the snap.
So they're going to add 11 seconds to the game clock. 9 minutes, 26 seconds remain in the first quarter, says referee Ronnie Blaufarb. And on the second and 10 play from the Gettysburg 35-yard line, the Green Tear on their first drive tonight, they fake the handoff to Chamberlain, and Callahan will take it upfield for just a couple, inside the 35 to about the 33-yard line. So that's a gain of two. And as you pointed out in the pregame, Jeff, Callahan might just bring a little bit more of that kind of dimension to the Green Terror offense compared to his two colleagues at quarterback.
And the offense always works a little bit better when you have the passing and the rushing game working in tandem.
Third down and eight from the Gettysburg 33-yard line. Callahan with a quick release, and he was under pressure that time, looking to go to Montgomery on the far sideline, and Callahan had to pull the trigger a little bit sooner than he was ready. Montgomery had not turned around for the ball yet. And now it's fourth and long for the Green Tear, and good rush upfield that time by the Gettysburg defensive line. Brett Haas for McDaniel will come on as the Green Tear have to punt it away on fourth down and eight. Haas this season averaging 37.3 yards per punt. He's dropped seven of them inside the 20-yard line. We'll have a good opportunity here as the Green Terror trail 7-0, and their drive stops here in Gettysburg territory, it would seem, at the Bullets' 34-yard line.
Late game, offense, 5-yard penalty, remains, fourth down.
So the Terror penalized for delay of game for the second time in this ball game. The first one came before the clock had even started. They were penalized on the opening kickoff, something I have never seen.
And this might actually end up helping Haas because he's going to try and get it inside the 10-yard line. This gives you a little bit more room, and with an average of just a little bit better than 36 yards per punt, this might help him.
Russo is back deep for the Bullets, and Haas sends it near the goal line, hands on the ball from Amelia, but he couldn't save it from going into the end zone, so it will be a touchback player. And the Bullets have the football back, leading at 7-0. We're in the first quarter with 8:34 showing on the game clock. Gettysburg looking to pick up their third consecutive victory and go over 500 for the first time this season, as the Centennial Conference will reach the halfway point this weekend and everybody's on the bye week next Saturday. So from the 20-yard line, Bullets have the football back and they'll go to the ground. And running through congestion to about the 21-yard line, there is not much there for the Bullets on the run, as Wickley is tackled after a gain of just one. Second and nine, Bullets. Miller to throw, flares it out, finds Andrews, wide open with the catch, gets to the 35-yard line. A 14-yard pickup and a first down for Gettysburg.
Well, the split screen has been the play du jour. And once again, some good tackling on the perimeter and allowed for a big gainer there for Gettysburg.
Miller takes the shotgun snap, and Wigley plunges out through a hole off the right side. Closed down quickly, but he dies for a gain of four. Brandon Jones, Green Care linebacker, given tackle credit. Wigley again averaging over 6 yards per tote, 325 rushing yards entering play today. And here he goes again, takes a hard hit, keeps his balance along the near sideline, and gets to the 43-yard line. Up for the big hit for McDaniel. It was Eddie Kendall, but it was Dan Traynor who eventually got Wigley down.
And Luke Fernandez was also there to help slow down Wigley's momentum.
Third down and about three for the Bullets. Counter play, Wigley with a first down in the middle of the field. He started right, cut back left, and takes it into Green Terror territory at the 43-yard line. So the Bullets with their fifth first down of the afternoon, and they quickly go back to the run, and Andrews with a second effort takes on tacklers along the near sideline, fights off the first man, and takes it down to the McDaniel 33-yard line. What I love about the running game so far of the Bullets is that first contact is no bother.
Especially with Andrews, he approached that first level. He slung his man down and got tons of yards after that first hit.
Andrews, a wingback out of Phoenixville, Pennsylvania. Here's Miller to throw. Deep ball overthrows everybody and into the end zone. On the pass pattern for the Bullets, it was Fred Caruso, who connected up with his quarterback to end their first possession with a score from 19 yards out. 7-0, the Bullets lead with 6:36 to play in first quarter action. And Miller a little bit too long with that pass, bringing up second down and 10 from the McDaniel 34-yard line. The Bullets back to the run as Wigley carries off the left side for just a couple. Bullets have five different running backs who all have over 100 rushing yards entering play today. Wigley's the leader. And penalty markers are thrown on a third and eight play.
Number 55, offense. 5 yard penalty remains. Third down.
The Bullets penalized for the first time today.
And that's something you have to pay attention to, Charlie, because the Bullets are the most penalized team in the Centennial this year. There was 1 week, I think it was 2 weeks ago, they received 100 yards of penalties.
Third down and 14. Miller with time in the pocket slips down as he plants the back foot, and the pass comes in low to Kyle Wigley. Coverage for McDaniel from Eddie Kendall. And that time Miller had a little bit of time, but you saw his back foot slip out a little bit there. So it's fourth and 14, and the Bullets are forced into a punting situation.
Now, you mentioned earlier that last night there was some rain, and we've already seen, I saw Kyle Wigley slip up earlier, and there Miller Guess he was bitten by the turf monster. He wasn't able to plant and throw. But now that the sun is out, I'm sure some of that dew that's on the turf will go away soon.
Junior Robbie Fay is averaging 33.2 yards per punt. A kill Tweedy signals the fair catch, bobbles it, and then makes it stick at the McDaniel 17-yard line. So the Green Terror have the ball back. And with 5:55 showing on the first quarter clock, it's the Bullets 7 and the Terror nothing. Here on McDanielAthletics.com, sunshine beginning to increase and brighten the day ever more as the afternoon wears on. Game time temperature was 60 degrees. Matty Callahan, the sophomore, getting his first collegiate start back on the field with the Green Terror offense. Tayod Campbell tries the middle of the field, and he is stopped cold. And I
know it has been good that we've seen some of the really short passes that have maybe helped make up for the lack of the running game so far, but McDaniel does need to get some type of a ground game going just to provide an additional look, or otherwise Gettysburg will make some adjustments on those split screens.
Campbell's forward progress gets him back just to the line of scrimmage, so it's 2nd and 10 from the 17. Callahan looks to his right, looking for Omelia, but it is broken up. Making the play for the Bullets was Dan Simnecki, a junior defensive back from New Jersey, one of a number of Bullets players who hail from New Jersey, right here in the heart of Pennsylvania. New Jersey, pretty close by, and a large percentage of the Gettysburg roster hails from that state. Incomplete pass makes it 3rd down and 10. Callahan taking his time, drops to throw. Ball's batted at the line again. Looking to go over the middle with it. And for the second or maybe third time, the Bullets get in the way of a Callahan pass at the line, and it'll be a 3 and out for the Green Terror.
And one thing that's kind of maybe confusing a little bit is that McDaniel, they have got a couple of guys that are 6'3" and 6'4" on that offensive line, but they haven't been able to open up a ton of passing lanes when Callahan's tried to go over the middle.
Haas to punt. Caruso, averaging over 13 yards per punt return, awaits, signals fair catch, and at the 38-yard line, he makes the fair catch, and then a penalty marker is fired by the side judge. Let's listen in for referee Ronnie Blaufar. Still sorting it out. Now Blaufar turns our way.
Holding, number 21, receiving team. 10-yard penalty would be enforced from the end of the run. First down.
So a holding call goes against Gettysburg, backing them up 10 yards. 5:01 to go in the first quarter, 7-0 Bullets lead on their home field. Next up for the Bullets, they'll be at Muhlenberg, a tough customer, 2 Saturdays from today. The Green Terror will also remain on the road, and in 2 weeks they will visit Lancaster to take on the F&M Diplomats. 1st and 10 Bullets from their 23. And the handoff goes to Nick Ulassen this time. Ulassen out across the 35 to the 36-yard line. Ulassen averaging 4.6 yards per tote, has 4 rushing touchdowns to lead the Bullets. Here's a swing pass. It's complete. Up the sideline goes Gettysburg, Brett Caruso, and Caruso takes it deep into McDaniel territory at the 19-yard line. And the Bullets, with that rapid-paced offense, went to the air, and Caruso rumbles down the sideline for a big Gettysburg first down and a long gainer.
And as soon as they get the offense down to the 18-yard line, they want to run the play.
Two running backs this time. And it's going to be Ulassen who will take it the distance. Ulassen scores from 18 yards out as he weaves his way up the middle of the field. And what a quick strike by the Bullets. Little swing pass to Caruso, winds up deep in McDaniel territory. And then Ulassen finds big running room up the middle and weaves his way in to give the Bullets a 13-0 lead.
You not only have to compete with the mix of different plays that Gettysburg's running, you also have to compete with the pace that they're running, too.
Garrett Long for an extra point attempt. And this one's up and through as well. 4:10 shows on the first quarter clock. And the Bullets have taken a two-score lead. It's 14-0. Gettysburg leading McDaniel here on McDanielAthletics.com.
Want to know more about the Centennial Conference? Log on to Centennial.org, your one-stop source for news, scores, stories, and more on Centennial athletes and athletics. Our website has all the latest news and results from the championship. Have something to say? Follow us on Twitter. Like what you see? Recommend us on Facebook. That's the Centennial Conference online and on your mobile device for everything on this and every conference event.
So the Bullets shake off a 10-yard penalty on the punt play. And a quick strike down the field gives them a 14-0 lead here on their home turf against visiting McDaniel. Football fell off the tee, and Garrett Long will readjust. Sean Montgomery and Akil Tweedy, the return men for the Green Terror, who have scored only 3 points in the first half of their four previous games. That was just a field goal by Spencer Wiersberg 2 weeks ago. Tweedy takes it near the 10-yard line, steps out of a tackle, and surges ahead of the 25-yard line. Ball popped free. There's a penalty marker on the play as well. And Gettysburg has recovered a Tweedy fumble at the 27, maybe the 28-yard line. Still awaiting word on the penalty, but the Bullets are bringing the offense out. So a huge mistake by McDaniel. He just gave up a quick strike score. McDaniel's
third and turn. Illegal block in the back on the kicking team. Penalty's been fine. Result of play. First down, Gettysburg.
So Gettysburg declines the penalty. They'll take the football in McDaniel territory at the 28-yard line. First turnover of the day. McDaniel had given it away and taken it away in equal amounts through the first four games. The Bullets go to the ground. And Kyle Wigley will pick up a couple to the 27. We'll call it a gain of one. It'll be second and nine. The Bullets ready to snap it again. Some movement at the line.
We were talking about it. When you're playing this Gettysburg team, you have to compete against the pace that they're using because it's a lot more difficult to substitute guys and get into the defensive sets when you want when Gettysburg's running no huddle the entire time.
Toss back. Running right is Wigley, I believe, and Wigley stopped at the 30-yard line. Beg your pardon, Travis Andrews on the carry. And he'll gain four to the McDaniel 30-yard line. Again, the Bullets look to the sideline, and they are ready to go to work right away on third and 11. From the McDaniel 30-yard line, Miller drops to throw, flares it out, and off the left hand of his target, Nick Ulassen. And Ulassen was all by his lonesome out there. That had the potential for a big game.
And that definitely, he would have at least gotten the first down because everybody in McDaniel had dropped into coverage. And so it was just Ulassen himself on that far sideline, but it was not a very good pass by a usually very accurate quarterback.
So it's third down and 11. The down marker shows. Miller, initial time in the pocket. Now he'll tuck it and go, and he'll be dumped at the 21-yard line. In for the big hit for the Green Terror was Claude Michael Richardson out of Silver Spring, Maryland. And Richardson laid the left shoulder into the quarterback Miller, stopping him at the 21-yard line. That's about 2 yards shy of where he needed to get. All right, so the down marker on the far sideline was showing third down. I was questioning that in my head, but the officials didn't do anything to stop it and correct it or anything. So as long as the bullets knew it was a fourth down play, I guess it's okay.
Yeah, they had it fourth down on the scoreboard. Right. I guess we know which direction to look now.
Yeah. So that threw me off. So not only does Richardson stop Miller, but he gets it back for the Green Terror at the 21-yard line. The Green Terror defense helps to dismiss that turnover on the kickoff return. And now the Terror back with the football at their 21-yard line. Off the right side across the 25, out to the 27-yard line. Freshman John Chamberlain on the run. He had 2 rushing touchdowns last week. But of course, they came late in the ball game after the Assinus Bears had built up a 35-0 lead. Down. 8 yards on the gain. It'll be second down and 2 for the Green Terror. Sean Montgomery, slow to get up, and favors the right leg as he heads for the Green Terror sideline. And now they set the clock back in motion with 2:25 to go in the first quarter. Trips left, second and 2. Bullets show blitz up the middle. The handoff goes to Chamberlain, and he runs into a wall of Gettysburg defenders. Needed to get 2 yards and came up short. And he'll put the football down at the 28-yard line.
And Gettysburg pretty much stacked the box. They had 8 or 9 guys in the box. When Chamberlain had the handoff, it was like he was going into a brick wall.
Freshman Ben Weber has checked in at tight end for the Green Terror. He'll set up on the left side of the formation. Third down and 2 McDaniel from their 29-yard line.
Minute 40 left in the first quarter.
Callahan gives it to Chamberlain. Chamberlain gets off the left side and picks up a Green Terror first down out across the 30 to the 32-yard line. Took it just a couple of inches wide and was able to turn the corner and move the chains for the Green Terror. Good field vision right there for the freshman.
And this is an offense that just, it's very young, but Chamberlain there getting some runs, and now you've got your tailbacks, your 2 primary ones, Campbell and Chamberlain, both first-year guys.
Chamberlain 5'9", 200 pounds, out of New Jersey. Here comes the run blitz. Callahan sets up, throws, finds a man, Keith Woodrow, at the 35-yard line, but he's hit immediately and spun to the ground after a completion good for 3 yards. Final minute of play of the first quarter. Bullets leading it here, 14-0 over McDaniel. The Green Terror committing the only turnover so far, but their defense just forced a 3-and-out. And the Terror moved the ball up to their 35-yard line on a 2nd-and-8 play. Snap back to Callahan, who gives it to Chamberlain. And he bulldozes across the 40-yard line up to the 41. That's going to be a six-yard pickup and a little bit shy of a first down as the final seconds tick off here in the first quarter. And we got a timeout call with 5.1 seconds remaining. And they're going to call for the chains. The ball at the 42-yard line of McDaniel, close enough for a measurement. And it'll be a first down for the Green Terror. Nose of the football.
First down for the game. 42-yard line.
And so they set the clock back in motion. The Green Terror kind of pal around with each other there as the final seconds tick down. And that is the end of the first quarter with a score here in Gettysburg, Pennsylvania. The Bullets 14 and the Green Terror nothing.
I'm Calvin Ball. I'm from Westminster. I do cross country and track and field, and I'm a senior. I chose McDaniel because it was local. I live here in the Westminster area. I could save a lot more money by commuting. And I also passed by the college, so I was always interested.
If you want to be a part of the vibrant McDaniel College community, schedule a visit and don't forget to apply early. Our early action deadlines of November 1st and December 1st are quickly approaching. Call the admissions office at 800-638-5005. Your personal admissions counselor is waiting to be connected with you because at McDaniel, you can expect the exceptional. Together with Jeff Arnold, Charlie Beckhardt on McDanielAthletics.com. First play of the second quarter, McDaniel down 14-0. Now moving left to right, tall pass is yanked down by Keith Woodrow up near the 46-yard line. And his forward progress takes him to the 47. And that's a gain of about 4. And it'll be second down and 6 for McDaniel.
And because of some of these short passing completions, it's helped open up the running game a little bit. We saw John Chamberlain with a couple of nice runs, and the balance has been good for McDaniel. Now they've got to try to find a way to score as they've struggled to keep up with this high-paced Gettysburg offense.
From a slot right formation, Callahan's under rush, throws underneath up at the 49-yard line. He finds his tight end, Kevin Rosari. Rosari, a sophomore out of Owings Mills, hit quickly after the reception and stopped at the 49-yard line. So the gain is about 4. That'll be third down and 3 for the Terror. That's Rosari's first pass completion in a while. And it's third and short. Here come the Bullets, and the pass is overthrown for Chamberlain out of the backfield. Bullets either timed that perfectly or were just a half a step across the line. They had a couple of blitzers coming. And again, enough pressure to force Callahan to pull a quick trigger. And he overthrows his man, and on 4th and 3, the Terror will have to punt it away.
And almost as soon as he threw that ball, Chris Miller, the linebacker, was coming right at him, knocked him down, and Gettysburg able to force the, eventually get him off the field.
Brett Haas takes a low snap from his 35-yard line and sends a high spiraling kick inside the 25-yard line. Caruso called for the fair catch. He's knocked to the turf. A penalty marker is thrown, and this is going to be fair catch interference against McDaniel. The ball is spotted at the 25-yard line. And Caruso came up to make a play on a high pop-up. Now, the officials are discussing it. I mean, I don't want to assume too much, but Caruso...
There was no foul on the play. The player was blocked into his own man. Result of the play, illegal touching, first down.
So they essentially pick up the flag, and McDaniel avoids another penalty. They've had a couple in this ball game so far. 3 for 15 yards. The Bullets also penalized 3 times. And from the 25-yard line, the Bullets go back on offense. Here's Miller scrambling away from pressure, throwing down the middle of the field, and almost a great grab. An over-the-shoulder attempt is made by Brandon Sparks. One-on-one down the middle of the field. As Miller didn't step up in the pocket, he stepped out of the pocket and just stepped right into a deep throw. And Dan Traynor step for step with Sparks. A long incompletion makes it 2nd and 10. Handoff Wigley, and he is stopped cold at the 25-yard line by McDaniel's Eddie Kendall, a junior defensive lineman.
Yeah, Traynor missed tackle was a big reason that Gettysburg got that second touchdown. They're able to do a good job to get his hand in, break up the pass.
12:50 clock running in the first half. 14-0. The Bullets lead the Terror here in Gettysburg, Pennsylvania this Saturday afternoon. And look out. Here is Miller slipping down inside the 20-yard line. The play continues. Miller off to his right and gets up to the 34-yard line. Now, Miller slipped down, was untouched, and his right knee, it's pretty clear to me, his right knee touched down. But they allow the play to continue, and he scrambles ahead for a gain of 8.
That was a good play by Richardson to just get to the perimeter and knock him down. That'll be 4th down. I think that's one of those plays where if you had the challenge capability, then Mike Hoyt would be throwing the red flag onto the field.
So he scrambles for 8, but he is 2 yards shy, and it's 4th down and 2, and a 3 and out from the Green Terror defense, including Dan Traynor with a solid defensive play on a deep throw down the middle. And Robbie Fay will send a spiral to the 31-yard line where Akeel Tweedy has running room up the middle of the field into Gettysburg territory and undercut as he crosses the Bullets' 40-yard line. A 28-yard punt return by Akeel Tweedy, and McDaniel has maybe the best opportunity.
On the receiving team, 10-yard penalty for the start of the foul. First down.
Well, unfortunately, a mistake in the form of a penalty will cost the Green Terror some sizable field position as they mark this off from the spot of the hold. So unfortunately, the Green Terror will start from their own territory after a fine punt return by Tweedy. Now the hold certainly might have broken him free, but still decent field position certainly for McDaniel, who trails 14-0 and looking to make something happen on offense today. Trips right. Bullets penetrate into the neutral zone. Again, no flag forthcoming. Callahan mishandles the shotgun snap, and that cost him precious seconds. He is sacked back at the 40-yard line.
A specter came in, and everybody was shouting that there was some movement up front. And you're wondering, you know, Callahan kind of had his head on the swivel looking all around, so when the ball came to him, he didn't really know what to do with it. And ultimately, he gets sacked.
5 yards to loss, 2nd and 15 as we approach the 11-minute mark of the second quarter. Bullets 14, Terror nothing on McDanielAthletics.com. Play fake, swing pass, complete to Oliveto. Oliveto takes on the first tackler, keeps his balance with the left hand, but gains no additional yardage as he gets just back to the line of scrimmage, the 40-yard line of the Terror. Well, I thought his forward progress was to the 40, but they put the ball down at the 39, so officially that'll be a 1 yard loss. So make it 3rd and 16 for the Terror. They'll operate from their 39-yard line. Callahan in the shotgun. He's got the football. Looks to his right, misses, picked off at the 48-yard line. Down the sideline, Gettysburg with their 2nd turnover today. And this was picked off by Chris Miller. Chris Miller takes it to the McDaniel 20-yard line. He read that play beautifully.
Yeah, he undercut the pass, and then he took it all the way up the far sideline, and that sets up a red zone opportunity for Gettysburg. We've seen Miller be disruptive. He's gotten some pressure on Callahan, and there he's able to jump around and pick a pass off.
From the 20-yard line, option toss goes to Caruso. And Caruso is around left end up to the 16-yard line. Knocked out of bounds at that spot after a 4-yard gain. Two turnovers today by McDaniel. They fumbled a kick return. And now at the snap of the football, or before the snap of the football, both lines move.
All start. Number 34, offense. 5-yard penalty remains. Second down.
So second and 6 will turn into second and 11 back at the tear, 21-yard line. Under 10 minutes to play in the first half. And McDaniel continues in search of points in the first half. After the turnover, Miller fakes the inside handoff, and he'll take off. Taken down by the ankles at the McDaniel 12-yard line. Out of bounds he goes. Drew Scott, the freshman linebacker of the tier, got him out of bounds. That's a 9-yard gain. Third and 2 bullets. Quickly up to the line. Andrews goes in motion. The toss goes that way. Andrews headed to the wide side of the field. He's got a first down and stumbles ahead inside the 10, close to the 5. They mark him out of bounds at about the 2. It's first and goal for Gettysburg.
Well, it's first and goal.
The Terriers were able to shake off a turnover earlier in this quarter, but right here, Kyle Wigley takes the fake handoff. Kyle Miller, or Zach Miller, I should say, takes it around left end, untouched. Zach Miller walks into the end zone. And a very nice play design. And from 1 yard out, the Bullets quarterback has extended the Gettysburg lead to 20-0.
The Bullets did a great job to sell that handoff. He kept it, and nobody had any idea that it was in his hands, and he waltzed into the end zone.
Garrett Long is perfect on PATs this season and remains perfect now, 13 out of 13. And this time, the Matty Callahan interception results in Gettysburg points. 20-yard drive from the Bullets, and with 8:59 to go in the first half, it's Gettysburg 21 and McDaniel nothing. We want to remind you to stick around at halftime. Luke Stilson sat down with women's soccer captain Avalon McCumber, or I should say women's cross-country captain Avalon McCumber, and talked about the strong start to the season and building towards the conference and regional meets. That's coming up as part of our Green and Gold Halftime Show right here on McDanielAthletics.com. We'll also have a statistical wrap-up for you, a check of other Centennial Conference scores on what has turned out to be a real beautiful Saturday afternoon. Sunshine overtaking things was overcast as we arrived here, and the temperature climbing into the mid-60s here. Tweedy and Montgomery for McDaniel. Tweedy backs up off his hands and into the end zone. He touched it at the 2-yard line, and then it went into the end zone and then went out the back corner of the end zone. Now, because he touched it at the 2, it was a live ball. He needed to either touch it down or get it out. It rolls out on its own impetus, and that results in a touchback for McDaniel. They'll have it at the 25-yard line.
One thing I think has been encouraging, Charlie, is we've seen McDaniel do a better job on third down, which was a point of emphasis for them coming in into this week. They're 50% in the first quarter. Now they just need that one big play to get things started.
Hand off Chamberlain. starts off the right side and brings it out to the 30 for a 5-yard gain. We notice that Tomasa Baylor is in at wide receiver for the Green Tear, one of the freshmen who has been seeing significant playing time, and statistically it's hard to argue with that, as 75 of the players on the McDaniel roster are either freshmen or sophomores. Second and a short 5. Handoff Chamberlain, and he will not get out of the backfield. Chamberlain wrapped up at the 26-yard line, we'll say. And the loss is 4.
That's Mike McGuire's 3rd tackle for loss this year. They're sensing the run, and we've seen it a couple times where Gettysburg banks on McDaniel running things, and it's tough to do a lot of audibilizing at the line of scrimmage because of the youth of this McDaniel team. You've got to keep it simple, and as a result, they're going to take that first play they get from the sidelines, not able to adjust, and it's a loss.
Callahan looked to his right, and now on a quarterback draw, we'll get out to the 30-yard line. Callahan off the left side, picked up about 4, but it's going to be 4th down. So the Green Terror trying to catch the Bullets defense snapping, or maybe a little bit over-aggressive, but the defense reacts well and forces McDaniel into a punt situation. Now, one thing the Terror running game has not had a lot of trouble with is getting tackled behind the line of scrimmage only 9 times through 4 games entering play today, but we've seen the Bullets be aggressive and successful. And Brett Haas hangs a spiral inside the 35-yard line of Gettysburg, where Caruso signals for a fair catch and makes it. So the Bullets will have it at the 34-yard line, leading by 3 scores, under 7 minutes to go in the first half. Brett Haas continues to perform in a very solid manner for the Green Terror. But, of course, the downside to that is that Haas has too many opportunities sometimes. Hand off, right side. And fighting off the initial contact, Nick Ulassen is up to the 36-yard line for a tough 2-yard gain. The Terran a 4-3. Miller delivers the ball to Caruso out in the right flat, and he'll gain a couple to the 39-yard line. A 2-yard gain, 3rd and 6. Again, the Bullets push the pace on offense. Miller hopping around, flushed out of the pocket, heads to his right, dives for the first down marker on the far sideline, and will be ruled out of bounds at the 42. The sticks went flying as Miller headed that way, and he appears to be about a yard shy.
You get the impression that Miller is a type of quarterback that you could see Matty Callahan kind of turning into. You know, a guy that can run quite a bit, and also somebody that is effective passing. And we've seen, you know, some glimpses of Callahan, you know, especially in the first quarter, just how effective he can be at passing the ball. But you have 5.5 minutes left. You really have to get some type of points on the board if you're McDaniel here.
With a 3-touchdown lead and a 4th-and-1 in their own territory, Gettysburg won't fool around. They'll punt it away. Akil Tweedy has the ball go between his legs, and they're saying that he didn't touch it. It's going to be touchdown at McDaniel's 2-yard line. I'm seeing everything today, Jeff. Tweedy came up to field the punt. It went through his hands and through his legs and was ruled that he didn't touch it. And Gettysburg covers it at the 2-yard line. That was a near disaster.
I think what happened was Tweedy just lost in the sun. He couldn't seem to find the ball, and I'm amazed that he didn't somehow make contact with it. And while you don't recover it and have a first and goal if you're Gettysburg, it's still a very difficult spot for McDaniel to be in on their own two.
A 55-yard punt by Fay. He got a good carry there. Tayod Campbell takes the handoff out of his end zone and spins up for tough yardage to about the two. We'll call it no gain.
And you wondered how aggressive this Gettysburg defense has been all game. If you want to try and stack the box again and go for the safety and maybe take a couple of chances here, I would say I probably would if I were Barry Streeter, considering you're up 21-0.
Second and 10 from the Terror 2-yard line. Callahan has two running backs, one each way. Handoff goes to Campbell. He's hit behind the line. Both linemen come in and they signal a safety. Right on target you are, Jeff Arnold. And the Bullets defense has put points on the board with 4:34 to play in the second quarter. 23-0 now. Gettysburg leads McDaniel.
And they brought everybody up right to the goal line, which is, and what ended up happening is that Campbell took the handoff inside the end zone, and he just couldn't spin out of trouble. So not only is this defensive line for Gettysburg one that is athletic, but it's one that also has been pretty physical up front, and it has been difficult for this McDaniel offensive line, which is very young, to try and defend against some of the different stunts and twists that the Bullets defense has thrown their way.
So the Green Terror with a free kick coming up. And points remain scarce for this Green Terror offense. And there have been a number of mistakes in this first half. And they just have not played the kind of ball game they were hoping for. Meanwhile, Gettysburg clicking on all cylinders as now the defense gets into the act. And it's a 23-0 Bullets lead. Bullets have beaten McDaniel 48 times, lost 18 times. There's been one tie. First meeting between these two squads, not these two squads, but the programs, was back in 1891. It's the longest rivalry in the Centennial Conference for the Green Terror, the Bullets.
Gettysburg has won each of the last three meetings. As we mentioned, only one player on this McDaniel team remembers what it was like to defeat Gettysburg, and that's Nick O'Melia.
You would typically see a punt on a free kick situation following a safety, but instead, McDaniel will kick it off the tee. It is fielded at the 30-yard line and up to the 45, the 47-yard line. Fred Caruso on the return. They let Mike Casper handle the kicking duties there, did the Green Terror. And great starting field position for the Bullets at their 48-yard line. Moments ago, they had even better field position following an interception of McDaniel, second turnover of the day. Here's a handoff to Nick Ulassen. Ulassen gets into the linebacker area to the second level and is cut down in McDaniel territory inside the 35-yard line. Making the tackle, Eddie Kendall of the Terror. First down, McDaniel after a 17-yard pickup. Bullets go right back to it. Pitch goes to Ulassen, who runs out of room along the near side of the field and takes it down to the Green Terror 34.
Well, what we've seen today from Gettysburg is that you kind of have to pick your poison a little bit. And on that first play from scrimmage, everybody was back in a two deep, and so it opened up a ton of space up the middle, and Gettysburg's gotten some big gains off those holes up the middle.
Inside handoff goes to Ulassen again. Brought down at the 32-yard line. Brandon Jones, one of the Green Terror captains, a junior linebacker out of Middle River, Maryland, was there for the knockdown. So the Terror hold on a couple of running plays here, and it's 3rd and 7, and they need one more stop. Miller rolls to his right, pulls the ball back down, and will be brought down at the 30-yard line. Again, it's Jones, and he teamed with Kendall. And Miller taken down after a one-yard gain. Fourth down and five. The Terror make a quick substitution now. Fourth and five. Exactly 3 minutes to play in the second quarter, clock running. And whistle stop play at the snap of the football.
Ball starts, offense, number 34, 5 yard penalty, still, fourth down.
The Bullets ticketed for a false start penalty. And let's see if this changes things. Fourth and 10, they're still in McDaniel territory at the 35-yard line now.
I wouldn't imagine it would, just because you're in no man's land where you're too far out of field goal range, but at the same time, you have a 23-point lead.
Ulassen is the wing back on the right side. Miller scrambles out of pressure, goes down the middle of the field, caught, touchdown, Gettysburg! From 35 yards away, the pass is caught by Jordan Kelso. Jordan Kelso had to fight for that one in the middle of the end zone, and Miller bought a little bit of time there. Waited for the pattern to be completed and put it on target. And the Bullets convert on fourth down in a big way. And now Garrett Long kicking out of the hold of Dan Simnecki has another one through the uprights. 2:31 to play in the first half, and Gettysburg has taken command, leading McDaniel 30-0. Well, if you're active on social media, you'll need to know that McDaniel Athletics is as well. Get the most up-to-date information by following us on Twitter, at McDaniel Sports. You can also like us on Facebook. Just search for McDaniel Athletics. We're also on Instagram, at McDaniel Sports, and of course, the most up-to-date information can always be found right here at McDanielAthletics.com. So the result of the inability to field the punt cleanly, and again, as you surmise it, maybe the sun got in the way and the tear thankfully never touched it, or it would have been a turnover, but instead it winds up in a safety as McDaniel pinned back at their 2 yard line, couldn't get out of there, and then the field position that Gettysburg got as a result of the free kick. So it's a 9-point swing in the span of just moments. And now on the kickoff, Akeel Tweedy brings it out across the 30 up to the 33 yard line for McDaniel, who again are scrambling offensively. And it's the same story. McDaniel may have committed themselves to doing something on the ground game today, and they may yet try to run the football and establish something, but down 30-0. The reason they're the top passing team in the conference is because they've had to do it so much and down by so much. First down, Green Terror from their 32-yard line. Callahan pulls down a high shotgun snap, and Tayod Campbell will lean out across the 35, fighting out to the 36-yard line for a 4-yard pickup.
It looks like McDaniel's calling their first timeout. They're really trying to get some type of points before going into halftime. And it's difficult to try and commit to a ground game when number one... it's actually Gettysburg calling the timeout, but it's difficult to commit to a ground game when you have to try and preserve as much clock as possible, and it's difficult. Also, too, it puts a lot more pressure on your defense as well. Now, we've mentioned that McDaniel's done a little bit of a better job on third down today, but it's still been a problem area for them all year, and when Gettysburg mixes their offense up so well, and they're able to get some big gains, you're kind of picking your poison as to what you want to do against them. And the last drive, they were booking on the pass. And it's tough to get pressure on a guy like Miller, who's mobile in the pocket anyways. And he was able to get a great pass downfield, 35 yards for Kelso. And if you're Gettysburg, you're sitting pretty confident. And this also allows you to take some more chances defensively.
So after the Gettysburg timeout, it's 2nd and 7 for McDaniel from the 35-yard line. And Callahan will air it out, and this is intercepted at the 30-yard line. No, they call it an incomplete pass. The ball ruled to have touched the ground, but Dan Simnicki, the junior out of Haddonfield, New Jersey, 180-pounder, was all over the football and just could not retain possession there.
That was some friendly fire. He ran into his team, Gordon Prince. If Prince is able to get out of the way, then Simnecki has got his second interception of the year.
I love the play call from McDaniel.
Another thing about it, too, is that Kelly just underthrew it a little bit.
Love the play call, not necessarily the execution. Quarterback draw here on 3rd and long. Callahan gets rocked as he runs to his left. Stopped shy of the 41-yard line and shy of a McDaniel first down. And Gettysburg calls their second timeout, stopping the clock with exactly 2 minutes to play in the first half. So the Bullets will have one timeout remaining. And on 4th down and 1, McDaniel's got a decision to make as the ball rests on the far side hash in McDaniel territory at the 41-yard line. I want to remind you that fall is a great time to visit McDaniel College. Come and experience what it's like to be a McDaniel student for a day. Attend a class, have lunch in the dining hall, tour the campus, learn more about admission, scholarship, and financing of private education. So don't miss out. Check out the McDaniel admissions website to reserve your spot for Friday, October 17th or Monday, November 17th. 4th and 1 tear. They'll play it safe and punt it away here, or at least that's what it appears on a 4th and 1. 2 minutes remaining in the first half. Haas stands inside the 35-yard line. Now McDaniel will split a receiver out to his left. Britton Hastings there, separated from the formation, and a long count. And now McDaniel, I think, is going to take a timeout. Yeah, they were seen to take a draw on all sides, 4th and 1. That's a smart way to play it. And McDaniel spends their first timeout, as you just heard. Again, a reminder that at halftime, Luke Stilson will be here, spending some time with McDaniel's senior captain, Avalon McCumber, of the cross-country team. Both the men's and the women's team very solid this year. The conference and regional meet was ahead during their conversation, and that is coming up as part of the Green and Gold halftime show. It remains 4th and 1. Bullets with a 30-0 lead in the final moments of the second quarter. Good snap back to Brett Haas. And Haas unloads a good kick. Caruso backpedals to a 16-yard line. Caruso to the 20. Navigates to the far side of the field, to the 30. And to the 35-yard line, where a penalty marker appears. So Caruso's picked his way ahead for about a 20-yard return, pending the penalty.
That's one of the advantages of having a guy like Brett Haas on your team, is you really need your punter to come through there and push Gettysburg back. And they had already really unloaded a good boot, got it inside the 20-yard line. But still Gettysburg, a minute 47 left. You think they're going for the jugular here probably, as by taking a couple of those timeouts, it preserves some time for them to maybe get one more score.
During the return, holding, number 22, receiving team. That penalty will be enforced from the end of the kick. First down.
So that's a big help as that backs Gettysburg up nice and deep into their own territory. Not that they can't score from anywhere on the field, but a minute 47 shows. And you heard as referee Ronnie Blaufarb turned his microphone on the field that there's a pretty good wind that it kicked up. It was breezy to start, and the breeze going from the Gettysburg side of the field laterally across toward McDaniel's side. So it's been a pretty constant but medium-sized breeze, but all of a sudden gusting up there. And Apparently Blaufarb forgot to turn his mic off as we heard that whistle echo throughout the stadium. Toss back goes to Caruso, turns the corner 25 up to the 30-yard line. And that'll be a gain of 4.
I still don't think he's found the off button yet on that microphone.
They ruled that Caruso was able to get out of bounds, stopping the clock with a minute 41 to play in the half. The Bullets have one timeout remaining. Play fake. Miller takes off. Miller's got a first down and pushed out of bounds at the 41-yard line by McDaniel's Eddie Kendall.
First down yardage.
Kendall mounting up the tackles again today. One of the defensive leaders of the Green Terror, who entered play with 23 tackles to his credit, including a sack and 2.5 tackles for loss. First down, Bullets. Miller wants to throw. Down the sideline he goes, overthrows his man at the 20-yard line. That was Travis Andrews, the wingback. That brings up second and 10 and stops the clock with a minute 28 to play in the half.
And you can just tell the relationship Miller has with his different wingbacks and wide receivers is that when he's missed guys on those long passes, it hasn't been by very much.
Hand off Wigley, slams on the brakes, turns to his left, and is up the sideline and out of bounds in McDaniel territory at the 41-yard line. He came to a screeching halt as the play was designed to go right, and he broke off to the left and found a big gap and moves the chains to the McDaniel 41-yard line with a minute 20 to play in the half. Now with a double wing set, the toss back goes to Caruso. Caruso gets crowded and stopped at the 40-yard line for a 1-yard pickup. Drew Scott leads the charge. Rob Martin came up in run support from his cornerback spot, and Martin remains on the turf as he appears to have sustained a leg injury or a cramp. Now to his feet, but they have stopped the clock, and Martin back down as he will need some attention. And so a minute 5 remains in the first half, and the clock stopped for an injury timeout. The longtime Green Terror trainer Greg Nibbling will come across the width of the field, and big swarming tackle by the Green Terror defense. And a lot of times, especially in a leg injury, that's where you called it friendly fire earlier. Somebody will catch somebody's knee or ankle by mistake, and Martin snaps to his feet and is able to jog off the field, a good sign. Just initially get rolled up in a big pile like that. So it is second down and 9 as we resume play here from the McDaniel 40-yard line. Miller zings a pass across the middle, finds an open target up to the 25-yard line. Kevin McCarthy, a junior out of Pennsylvania, makes his first catch of the day, and Miller with a rifling pass for a first down. Low snap, picks it up off the turf, flares it up, incomplete. Wigley was covered, and Miller, who's not a particularly tall quarterback, at 5'11", had to put a little bit of air under that pass. It went incomplete.
Now we're seeing Miller, after he stuck over the middle, the number of his passes in the first quarter and early on in the second quarter, trying to work the sidelines with Gettysburg having only one timeout remaining.
Full men on the field. 5-yard penalty remains. First down.
So the Terror are going to be assessed with a substitution penalty. 12 men on the field, and that advances the football 5 yards to the 19-yard line. It's now 1st and 5. Miller scrambles out of trouble. He's got running room, and he'll get to the end zone. Zach Miller from 24 yards out picks up his 2nd rushing touchdown today and his 5th of the season. And the Bullets take it nearly the length of the field in short order. That took about a minute off the game clock. And here's Garrett Long, who's been a busy man today. Simnecki will put it down on the extra point try. Long left foots it up and through. 40.8 seconds remain in the first half. Gettysburg in control, 37-0 over McDaniel.
And I think that you come into this game and you're McDaniel, you know this is going to be a challenge against Gettysburg, a team that has 9 returning starters on their offense, 8 returning starters on their defense. But I think what makes this a little bit more difficult is that last week you faced an Ursinus team, which is more of a pro-style type of offense that doesn't really go with any no huddle. And then you face Gettysburg today, and it's just been difficult for the Green Tear to get the right personnel on the field. You saw the last defensive penalty they were called for was us having 12 different guys out there. You've seen tons of times where McDaniel's got a guy racing off the field just in the nick of time before the ball is snapped. And so I think it's not only been adjusting to what Gettysburg is bringing offensively, it's just adjusting to the pace which they have done it, and it's made it difficult to adjust.
Bullets looking for their third straight win. And they've had a solid first half performance on both sides of the football. And now the kickoff will sail into the end zone over Tweedy's head. And the Green Terrier will take it over after the touchback at their 25-yard line. 40.8 seconds remain. And the Terrier have not scored a touchdown in the first half so far this year. Only a Spencer Wiersberg field goal against Muhlenberg 2 weeks ago. The only time that McDaniel has lit the scoreboard lights in the first half of any game this year. So we'll set up in a trips right formation, spread it out with Chamberlain in the backfield. Sophomore quarterback Matty Callahan getting his first start, and he sends a flare pass to Chamberlain, who catches and gets out to the 32-yard line. Chamberlain for a gain of 6. McDaniel's got 2 timeouts remaining. Clock ticking down. Callahan stands in the pocket over the middle. He goes to Chamberlain, and Chamberlain picks up a first down across the 40 up to the 44-yard line. They'll stop the clock temporarily while they move the chains. The Terror quickly back up to the line of scrimmage. They're set. Shotgun snap back to Callahan. Callahan throws it into traffic and finds a man at the 35-yard line. Nice catch is made by J.T. Katowski. A pair of first downs on consecutive plays for the Green Tear, and they will spend their second timeout.
And that was not much of a window for Callahan to find Katowski, and he had 2 defenders right around him. But Callahan was able to split the difference. That's the best pass that he has thrown all game.
I agree wholeheartedly. And the best pass that he's probably thrown since the late score at Muhlenberg, or not at Muhlenberg, but home against Muhlenberg a couple of weeks ago when he came in to engineer the final possession of the game, and the Green Tear scored on that one. And he delivered a nice ball on that one and a nice play on the back end. But now McDaniel senses the end zone, but only 3.2 seconds remain. They've got 1 timeout, but this could be the final play. Chamberlain's on a wing to the right, picks up a blitzer. Callahan rolls that way. Callahan steps into a throw, goes into the end zone, into traffic, and incomplete. Sean Montgomery got hands on the football, paid the penalty. He got rocked in the end zone in the deep part. And Callahan got it there into a crowd on the Hail Mary, but it goes incomplete. And we have reached the break in Gettysburg, Pennsylvania. Shirk Field at Musselman Stadium, where the Bullets are looking for their 3rd consecutive win. Entering play today at 2-2, McDaniel at 1-3 overall. And at halftime, it's the Gettysburg Bullets 37 and the McDaniel Green Terror nothing.
Here's a news flash. McDaniel College is named a best bang for the buck by Washington Monthly and a best value by Kiplinger's Personal Finance. That's in addition to a top-tier ranking by U.S. News, the academic version of the BCS football poll and continuing inclusion among only 40 colleges nationwide known to change the lives of their students. How do we do that? McDaniel offers each student a customized and personal liberal arts education plus faculty-student collaboration, a true McDaniel tradition in the classroom, lab, studio, dining hall, and on every court and playing field on campus. McDaniel prepares students for successful lives of leadership, service, and social responsibility. Come see for yourself. Check out McLive, our online calendar, at McDaniel.edu for upcoming events, performances, exhibitions, lectures, and more that are free and open to the public. Again, to learn more, visit McDaniel.edu or call 410-857-2230 to schedule a campus visit.
Back at halftime on McDanielAthletics.com, Charlie Beckhardt with Jeff Arnold. One of the great traditions here at Gettysburg College is the Gettysburg Bullets Marching Band, which was founded in 1909. This is their 105th season of performing, and they will perform here at halftime this afternoon at the Brick. McDaniel has more to do than just make adjustments. They need to improve in many areas, execution, elimination of some mistakes. Two turnovers in the first half, one of them resulted in points, and McDaniel finds themselves down to the Gettysburg Bullets 37-0 this afternoon, game number 5 of the Centennial Conference football season. And Jeff, what were some of your impressions of the first half?
I think the biggest thing that stood out to me is that McDaniel hasn't been able to keep up with the pace that Gettysburg has set. They play a no-huddle type of offense, and it's pretty simple, but at the same time, it's a little discombobulating if you're the Green Terror because you faced pro-style type of offense last year, and it looks like on defense, McDaniel's just hustling most of the time to get the right personnel on the field. They haven't been able to make a whole lot of adjustments. And then after last week, you had the quarterback for Gettysburg, Zach Miller. He didn't have any touchdown passes. Well, he's making up for it so far. And Gettysburg, they've benefited from a couple of mistakes on the McDaniel side. They had the interception. They recovered the fumble on the kickoff return. And those type of mistakes against a team like Gettysburg, you just can't afford to make. And they've turned them into points.
This is a learning experience for so many young players on the McDaniel squad. And Matty Callahan getting the start today. It was their intention to run, it would appear, a little bit more of an option style offense, take advantage of his ability with his legs. And we saw Campbell and Chamberlain, who've had varying measures of success in the ball game. We didn't see a lot of Campbell in the second quarter as McDaniel had to go to the air a little bit more. They're starting to get some other receivers in into the offense, but you know, where does McDaniel go in this second half as far as what they have to do offensively? The game situation would clearly call for a passing attack because they're down by 37, but there's also this building the program aspect of things, and so there's always the possibility that McDaniel will stay true to who they want to be, not necessarily who they have to be today. I'm not saying let's cash in our chips, but you might see them try to work on some things that they think they can be successful with so that they can continue to be successful with those things.
Yeah, as the Bullets started to extend their lead, you started to see Callahan take some more chances right down the middle of the field. I thought the intermediate passing game worked pretty well in the first quarter. But once you got to the second, then the problems on third down started to pile up again. And Gettysburg, you know, they had the safety. They had that kickoff fumble from McDaniel that ended up turning into points. And they made use of some great field position to be able to do some things and also take some more chances. And with a 37-0 lead, you have to imagine that they're going to play very aggressive in the second half. And I also think, too, they'll probably sit down some of their key players because, remember, after the bye next week, they'll be playing Muhlenberg and Johns Hopkins back-to-back, two of the best teams in the Centennial. But I would agree with you. I think you're going to take some things that you want to be working on and you're going to try and start doing them in this third quarter. You don't have a whole lot to lose when you're down 37-0.
Last year in a 50-28 victory at Gill Stadium in Westminster, Gettysburg rolled up 636 yards of total offense, and shown themselves to be a dominant team offensively in that ball game. Today, through one half of play, they've outgained McDaniel 358-114, having run 12 more plays from scrimmage than have the Green Tear. We'll take a complete look at the numbers of the first half as our Green and Gold halftime show continues. But up next, Luke Stilson spends some time with senior captain Allison McCumber. We'll have that for you coming up next on McDanielAthletics.com.
Here's a news flash. McDaniel College is named a best bang for the buck by Washington Monthly and a best value by Kiplinger's Personal Finance. That's in addition to a top-tier ranking by U.S. News, the academic version of the BCS football poll and continuing inclusion among only 40 colleges nationwide known to change the lives of their students. How do we do that? McDaniel offers each student a customized and personal liberal arts education plus faculty-student collaboration, a true McDaniel tradition in the classroom, lab, studio, dining hall, and on every court and playing field on campus. McDaniel prepares students for successful lives of leadership, service, and social responsibility. Come see for yourself. Check out Mick Live, our online calendar at McDaniel.edu for upcoming events, performances, exhibitions, lectures, and more that are free and open to the public. Again, to learn more, visit McDaniel.edu or call 410-857-2230 to schedule a campus visit.
We continue here on the Green and Gold Halftime Show, halftime of McDaniel and Gettysburg here on McDanielAthletics.com. Sports Information Director Luke Stilson joined this week by cross-country senior Avalon McCumber. Avalon, thanks for some time. Let's start off, let's talk about the solid start you guys have had to the season so far. You guys have had three good races so far. Talk about how you guys off to a good start this year.
Well, we had, you know, two good, strong races at the beginning of the season, and our last race was actually back. We raced at Dickinson, and everyone did amazing. I think we placed a lot higher than our coaches expected. They were really pleased with our performance, so it was a really good confidence booster for the season.
All right, that's the course you guys will be running when it comes to regional time. Obviously, you guys ran a short course, but it'll be the same course, so it's a little bit of a chance to see that course before you get ahead to regionals. So let's kind of talk about you guys kind of really had your first week off from meet, so really a hard training week for you guys last week. Back in action today is, you know, a little more last night from this air. So talk about kind of that, having that week off and kind of regroup and get back to the training mode.
Well, it was really great. It was definitely, because when you have a little meet, you can't put in high mileage, so it was really interesting to have the week off, and I feel like it was probably one of the best training weeks I've ever had. We did a lot of mileage, I think everyone was pretty exhausted, but it felt really good. Like, I feel like it was very, it was much needed for us to perform, so hopefully that will pay off today in our race.
Mm-hmm. Let's look ahead a little bit. You guys are racing Penn State Harrisburg today on Friday. Yesterday by the time this airs, but and then because next week you guys are heading down to Virginia and then another 10 days off, race a short race, but just kind of intermediary race there, Stevenson 4K race before the conference meet. So talk about kind of building now towards conferences at Haverford come I guess November 1st.
Well, again today I think we're going to do really well, so I'm really excited about that. So hopefully that will boost our confidence, and I also really like that we're doing a bunch of kind of different distances, because I think that kind of, you can't get stuck into a routine for the 6K, so I think it really helps if we're doing some 4Ks, some 5Ks, so that every race is kind of, you know, something new, you're not getting stuck in a stride. So with that, and then I'm sure when we have our 10 days off, we'll put in some pretty high miles, so that should be good and should prepare us for regionals.
Yep. Let's talk a little bit about some of the team. Let's start on the women's side. Obviously, you've been up to the front this year now as the senior, kind of leading the way, taking on that role. But also up front, you got Claire back, obviously, who's always been a front runner. And Kelsey Binion and Mimi Lawrence, you guys kind of the core coming back. Talk about the four of you guys kind of leading the young group.
Well, so we've been together for, I guess this is almost the third year now. So we work really well together. I think we have a really strong team dynamic. We really support each other, so that's really nice to have your teammates being your friendly competitors. I know Claire and I really worked well together in the last 4K, so it's kind of a bummer that she only does the short races, because she's really good at pacing, so that was really fun to run with her and Kelsey and Mimi are just always super consistent, solid runners, so they're great additions to the team.
You guys kind of added a couple more to kind of round out your top six with Becky and Beth. What kind of their addition to the team?
Yeah, so they're new. So I think Beth took a couple years off of running, so she's getting back into that, and it's really interesting to see her. She keeps improving and improving, so that'll be awesome. You know, once regionals rolls around, I think she'll be really awesome. And Rebecca's another one of our top runners. She's really great. She was awesome in high school, and is continuing that here. So it's really nice to have a couple new great people on our team.
Yeah, obviously you guys lost a couple last year, a couple of top mm-hmm. runners in Becky and Jasmine Moore in track. On the track side, but also in cross country as well. So, you know, kind of the two that have come in and really kind of replaced those two for you guys.
Mm-hmm.
Let's flip over to the men's side a little bit. Obviously, you guys trained together a lot, so you guys did get to know each other. Men really strong at the top this year. Peter's a senior, obviously, Peter Markle, and then Calvin Ball coming along really strong in senior year. Jim's come on, Jim Heilman, and Chris Jones, obviously, see what he's been with this. Talk about those four and kind of what you've seen from them to be on the men's side.
Well, Peter and Jim haven't been injured, so they've been really consistent. But Peter, Colin, and Chris have been dealing with some injuries, so hopefully those will get solved before regionals because they are really useful to the team. We really need them to place well. But we also have a lot of new freshmen, so that's really helping. But yeah, those are the four solid, good runners that we have. So yeah.
Yeah, and a couple of those freshmen, John Alexander's kind of really been kind of risen to the top of that freshman group. Talk about what you've seen from him so far as a freshman, and even as a freshman.
I think he just works really hard. I think he really enjoys running, so that definitely helps. But he always seems, you know, excited to race and come to practice, and he's always really enthusiastic about his races afterwards, really happy with how they went. So I think he really brings something to the team dynamic and makes it a positive experience.
Let's fast forward a little bit. We'll get through cross-country season now here in the next month, conference meet, and in the regional meet, and let's jump into indoor track season, outdoor track season. Talk a little bit what you kind of foresee for track season. I know we're still a month away from indoor really getting started, but I know Coach Renner's been really excited about looking forward to the 4x8s and the DMRs especially, and mm-hmm. what you got on both sides.
Yeah, I think we should have probably a pretty good 4x8 team. We kind of have big shoes to fill because last year our 4x8 team went to ECACs and was amazing. But with Rebecca, and I don't know if Beth's going to run the 4x8, but we have some good people to run in it, so that should be good. And we have a lot of distance people, and we actually are going to have a specific distance coach.
Right.
So that should be really helpful. So, yeah, I'm excited. I'm not really sure what track has to offer, but it's going to be fun.
Right. So, kind of mention coaches, you guys have got a couple new assistants bound for cross country, Coach Jesse and Coach Keith. Talk about what they've kind of brought to the program and kind of, you know, just different voices and different training methods that they've been able to bring.
Well, I've really liked them. They've it's just kind of like a different perspective. So it's working with Coach Renner. I think between, you know, their perspectives and Coach Renner's perspectives, they can really like come up with the best ideas possible and come up with the best training routines possible. So they've been really good. I think they've brought a lot to the team.
Yeah, kind of just really a different voice more than anything. Mm-hmm. Kind of some different ideas. And it's kind of shown, it's paid off early on.
Mm-hmm.
Final thoughts from you as you get ready here, get into the last part of your senior year of cross country season and look forward to track season.
Well, I'm just really hoping that we continue to improve. I think we've steadily improved since our first meet. I'm really optimistic about today, so I'm hoping that we can just continue this trend of getting better and better and continue until regionals and, you know, do the best that we've ever done.
Right, and you know, it's really in cross country, it's all about running as much. It's a tough conference when it comes to mm-hmm. the CDL conference, and probably one of the toughest regions in the country as well when you get to the regional meets. It's really about running as a class and doing what you guys can do and see where the chips fall at the end of the meet.
Yep.
Evelyn McCubber, my guest on the Green and Gold Halftime Show. Evelyn, thanks for the time.
Thank you.
We'll get you back to Charlie and Jeff. They'll get you set for the second half right here on McDanielAthletics.com.
Want to know more about the Centennial Conference? Log on to Centennial.org, your one-stop source for news, scores, stories, and more on Centennial athletes and athletics. Our website has all the latest news and results from the championship. Have something to say? Follow us on Twitter. Like what you see? Recommend us on Facebook. That's the Centennial Conference online and on your mobile device for everything on this and every conference event.
Avalon McCumber there at halftime, spending some time with McDaniel Sports Information Director Luke Stilson. And in the meet at Penn State Harrisburg, both the women's and the men's team captured the titles. And Avalon finished first individually, a 1-2-3-4-8 finish by McDaniel women runners. So congratulations to both the Green Terror men's and women's teams on victories at the Penn State Harrisburg meet. Halftime here in Gettysburg, Pennsylvania, where McDaniel trails Gettysburg by a score of 37-0. Welcome back to our webcast on McDanielAthletics.com. Together with Jeff Arnold, I'm Charlie Beckhardt. Time to take a look at the numbers of the first half. Very one-sided Gettysburg's way as they have outgained McDaniel 358-114, including 227-34 on the ground. Gettysburg has run twice as many running plays as McDaniel has, 34-16. Through the air, Gettysburg with 131 yards to 80 for the Green Terror. The Green Terror have been penalized 5 times in the game for 30 yards, the Bullets 6 times for 40. Time of possession, very, very close. On third down, McDaniel 2 of 8, Gettysburg 3 of 8. And in the red zone, Gettysburg is 4 of 4 today. So again, a 358-114 advantage through one half of play in total offense favoring the Bullets, who were led today by their quarterback, Zach Miller, with 2 rushing touchdowns. He's got 131 yards, 131 yards through the air, I should say. He's got 2 rushing touchdowns, 75 yards on the ground. So 206 yards of offense accounted for by the Gettysburg quarterback. 9 rushes, 2 touchdowns, 6 of 12 passing, 2 touchdowns and a long of 45. 3 of those passes went to Fred Caruso for 65 yards and a score, and Jordan Kelso had the other score that covered 35 yards. For McDaniel, John Chamberlain leads the way on the ground, but with just 20 yards on 6 carries. Tayod Campbell had 6 carries, held to 9 yards. Callahan scrambled for 5 on 4 official rushes. Callahan threw the air 10 of 17. He was picked off once, threw for 80 yards, and has been sacked once in the game. 2 catches apiece from Mike Oliveto, John Chamberlain, Nick O'Melia, and Keith Woodrow. Oliveto with 20 yards through the air. Punting Brent Haas, 37.8 yards per boot on 5 today. Robbie Fay with 36.7 on 3, including a long of 55, which was just a disastrous turn of events for McDaniel. As we look back in hindsight, Jeff Arnold, it was that swing which really gave Gettysburg some breathing space. And what happened in that sequence of events was McDaniel forced Gettysburg into a punt situation, and Akil Tweedy, the return man, misjudged the ball, couldn't see the ball, whatever happened. He never touched it despite being very close to the ball. It rolls and Bay winds up with a 55-yard punt, but it dies at the 2-yard line of McDaniel, and from there the wheels kind of came off the cart.
Yeah, they really did. And what ended up happening too is Gettysburg, they got really aggressive and they started stacking the box and making it difficult for McDaniel to push their way out of the shadow of their own end zone. They were going to stick to the ground and kind of chip their way along. If you miss fire on a pass, then it's a pick six pretty much automatically. And that was a real problem. And so overall, McDaniel in a difficult spot, 37-0. This is the very, they've run the gauntlet the last couple of weeks. You know, you have to face your sinus, you have to face Muhlenberg. Today, get Gettysburg, who is an experienced lineup, 17 returning starters from last year. And this is really the very end of a difficult stretch. And Gettysburg has always been a challenging team to play, not only by what they bring to the table, but every program has got that one team that gives them problems. And for McDaniel, Gettysburg has been that club.
So trailing 21-0 at that point with McDaniel pinned back close to their own goal line. They gave up a safety. The Bullets went up 23-0 on the free kick. The Bullets used just 5 plays following that, covered 52 yards in just a minute 55 to take a 30-0 lead. And then Zach Miller's 19-yard touchdown run, his second rushing touchdown of the day, covered 74 yards in 7 plays. That took only a minute 7, and Gettysburg with a 37-0 lead over McDaniel. The fast pace of their offense has been too much for McDaniel to keep up with. The scoring drives by Gettysburg today, amazingly, have taken no longer than 2 minutes and 27 seconds off the clock. That was the max that was on their first possession of the day. 8 plays, 62 yards. 2:25, exactly 60 seconds, 1:08, 1:55, and 1:07. That is what it has taken the Gettysburg offense to score today. 5 touchdowns and a safety. They're up 37-0. And we'll kick it off to McDaniel to begin the second half.
And it just shows you how useless that time of possession statistic really is. Last in the Centennial time of possession, no surprise, because everything is no huddle for Gettysburg. And they were doing everything lightning quick. And we'll see what type of adjustments Mike Hoyt is telling his team to make in the second half, now that they know at the speed at which Gettysburg is going to run things.
They don't want to hold the ball. They want to have the ball in the end zone. And they have done it successfully in this first half, as we're underway in the second now. The kickoff fielded by Tweedy from his 5, middle of the field, 25, and held up at that spot. A 20-yard return for Akeel Tweedy of McDaniel. They'll set things up and bring the offense out for the first time in the second half, trailing here 37-0. Quick look at other Centennial Conference action today. Hopkins in the final seconds of the ball game at Baltimore, leading Juniata big, 56-14. The number 10-rated team in the nation will remain perfect this season. Halfway through the third quarter at Ursinus, the Bears lead visiting Moravian 10-0. Muhlenberg shutting out Susquehanna early in the second quarter, 21-0. The Mules lead the Crusaders. And F&M with a 14-10 lead over Dickinson as they're just underway in the second half. McDaniel in their first play of the second half goes to the ground, and Tayod Campbell will pick up 4 off the left side. Ball out to the 30-yard line as Drew Winters is given tackle credit. 2nd and 6, Green Terror. Here come the Bullets again, showing blitz pressure.
And I think this is going to be an offsides against Gettysburg, as a member of the McDaniel team popped out of his crouch, but he was quickly indicating that he was caused a false start. And if that's the case, then it would be 5 yards against the Bullets. But let's see what the ruling is.
False start, number 71, offense. 5-yard penalty, remain. Second down.
Maybe not.
Indeed. The Bullets are, you know, jumping up to the line of scrimmage, jumping into the neutral zone and back out. And they had 2 players up close to the line of scrimmage that time. Here they come again, putting pressure on the line of scrimmage, and Callahan drops a throw, stands in the middle, and throws the slant, complete to Oliveto. Oliveto sheds a tackler. Oliveto into Gettysburg territory at the 38-yard line. A big first down pickup, and a big lift for the Green Terror to begin this second half. McDaniel quickly up to the line of scrimmage. They snap it quickly. Here Campbell feeling his way ahead, and he's up to the 37-yard line of Gettysburg. Just a short pickup for the freshman, Tayod Campbell. Campbell again held to 9 rushing yards on 6 carries in the first half.
And on that pass to Oliveto, a great job by the offensive lines to create those passing lanes for Callahan. Remember, he's just 5'11", but he found Oliveto on the post.
Here's a swing pass, and it's complete to Nick O'Melia on the far side of the field near the McDaniel bench. O'Melia knocked out of bounds at the 32-yard line. That's a 7-yard gain. It'll be 3rd and 2 for McDaniel, and McDaniel in the hurry up here. They're trying to force the issue here with 13:25 to play in the opening moments here of the third quarter. Shotgun snap back to Callahan. Callahan lobs it downfield. Some contact inside the 5-yard line. O'Melia looking for a call. He will not get it. It is incomplete inside the 5-yard line of Gettysburg. O'Melia feels like he was tripped up from behind.
He was very angry about that call, and I think he had a point. It looked like the arms of the defender were all over him. And now you're going to go for it on fourth down. Obviously, four down territory, down 37-0.
One of the reasons it might not have been called interference was the possibility of an uncatchable ball. Here on fourth down and short, McDaniel goes to the ground, and they did not get there. Stop shy of the 30-yard line. Well short of a first down, and the Bullocks defense gets the job done on what started off as a promising drive for McDaniel. They penetrate into the Bullocks territory and pick up one first down, but now turn it over at the 31-yard line. And on fourth down today, that's McDaniel's first opportunity there.
A good tackle by Steve Pondo-Voigt, 6'3", a huge wingspan.
Toss back goes to Caruso. Caruso gets to the edge and is ripped out of bounds at the 36-yard line by McDaniel's Eddie Kendall. And that'll be a gain of about 6 yards on the play. Kendall in the first half had four tackles. Drew Scott led the way defensively for McDaniel with 11 tackles. Brandon Jones had five. The Bullets put it on the ground again, and Nick Ulassen surges out to the 39, and Drew Scott's got a dozen tackles today.
Drew Scott, what a freshman year that he has had. Comes in third on the team, somebody that's got an eye for the ball, and has been really one of the freshmen that stood out so far.
Third and two, and McDaniel rises up on defense. They're signaling that the ball came out, but they ruled a runner down at the 39-yard line. That was Ulassen again, and he comes off the field gimpy. And on fourth and short, the Terror will force a three and out. Drew Scott had eight tackles against Moravian, two interceptions in the season opener at Catholic when he was named the Centennial Conference's Defensive Player of the Week. And now with a dozen tackles today, a new career high for the freshman. Robbie Fay to punt it away. Gets into it, and it is fumbled inside the 20-yard line by Akil Tweedy. Had trouble again and covers it up at the 19-yard line of McDaniel. So no return. Green Terror face a long field with 11:45 to play in the third quarter and down 37-0 to homestanding Gettysburg.
And what ended up happening there was that Tweedy had already started looking up field, and so the ball went off of his hands, and not wanting to get any more negative yardage, he just fell on it.
Trips right formation, McDaniel from their 19-yard line on first down, and this time Gettysburg off the left side. Let's see if...
Number seven, offense.
Nope.
5-yard penalty, remaining. First down.
Olivetto of McDaniel is called for moving too early, and the Terror forced back to their 14-yard line. It's now first and 15. McDaniel's seventh penalty today. Swing pass finds Omelia on the far sideline. He takes a hit and is forced down at the 21-yard line. That'll be a gain of two for Nick Omelia. Local product out of Francis Scott Key High School. Amelia, a fifth-year senior. They fake the handoff to Chamberlain, and Callahan, straight up the gut, gets back to the line of scrimmage for no gain. Gettysburg not fooled on that running play.
And Amelia is saying that the big thing that drew him to McDaniel was because just about 15 minutes away from his house.
Third and eight. Callahan's got Chamberlain in his right. Again, movement from both lines, and another false start by McDaniel, and they're going to have to develop more discipline here as Gettysburg comes at you from all avenues, and they're going to cheat up and back off and try to force the issue, and McDaniel's just going to have to find some discipline here. It is third down and 14. Callahan steps up in the pocket. Penalty marker fired in the backfield. Callahan is stopped and stood up at the 20-yard line. He scrambles ahead for about 4 or 5 yards, but another penalty against McDaniel.
And Charlie, I have to imagine that maybe one of the cardinal sins for football is being called for offensive holding against a three-man rush.
They got Riley Johnson, one of the offensive linemen there. Gettysburg declines the penalty to force a 4th and 9, and Caruso will stand outside his 45-yard line. Bullets hoping to get good field position here as Brett Haas takes the snap and sends a high and short kick. It hits at the McDaniel 42-yard line, backs up, and will be covered at the 40-yard line by McDaniel special teamer Luke Fernandez. And so Gettysburg in business once again with 10:31 to go in the third quarter. And winning the battle of field position here in the last couple of minutes off the game clock. Slot left formation. Caruso goes in motion. The handoff goes to Ulassen. Ulassen up the middle of the field. A short gain. And he will be wrestled to the ground by linebacker Drew Scott.
Caruso goes in.
It's a gain of 4, 2nd down and 6. Toss back goes to Caruso. With blockers in front, Caruso gets cut down shy of the McDaniel 35-yard line. Leading the way was Nick Marino, a freshman defensive back out of Westmont, New Jersey. Call it a gain of 2 to make it 3rd down and a short 5. From the spread wing, they'll have twin receivers each way. Miller will stand in the pocket, flare it out. He finds Ulassen for a 1st down as he gets to the sideline, pushed out of bounds by McDaniel's Richard Settle, another freshman linebacker. Not before the Bullets can move the chains and take it to the McDaniel 29-yard line. Back quickly to the line. They waste no time, do the Bullets. Handoff goes to Ulassen, and this time he meets a wall of Green Terror defenders at the line. And in among the tacklers for the Terror was junior linebacker Brandon Jones. Jones out of Eastern Tech High School in Middle River. Miller takes a low shotgun snap and delivers a strike over the middle. Pass to the 15-yard line. And Kelso carries inside the 10. Jordan Kelso to the 8-yard line. That time a blistering pass from Miller was right on the money.
And the speed at which Gettysburg's offense moves is impressive. But the other thing, too, is the yards after catch that their wide receivers have gotten.
They go back to the ground, and Ulassen is off the right side. He's inside the 5-yard line. And this will be a 1st and goal. For the Bullets, who again do not huddle up. They just get right back to the line of scrimmage. I should say 2nd and goal for the Bullets. Motion from the right side, wing back. And Miller is... Well, Miller got dumped first. He handed it off to Ulassen, and he got dumped as well. So that time the Green Terror playing very aggressive on defense. The loss is back to the 7-yard line.
A great play by Zachary Collette, who went very high, but using that upper body strength to drag the man down.
First time that the Green Terror have gotten big pressure into the backfield on a running play. On a quick in, Miller throws it too tall for his intended target. That's Jordan Kelso, who's looking for him again. It's incomplete in the end zone. That'll be 4th down for Gettysburg, and Garrett Long is going to come on and have an opportunity. Add 3 more. This season, Long is 2 of 4 on his field goal tries with a long of 37. That came last week. This will be from the right side hash mark, a 24-yard attempt out of the hold of Simnecki. Good spot. Kick is up long enough and good. 24-yard field goal from Garrett Long. A 175-pound sophomore from Mechanicsburg, Pennsylvania. He's been perfect on all of his PATs so far this season, and it includes 5 today. And now the field goal has extended the Gettysburg lead to 40-0 with 8:02 to play in the third quarter here in Gettysburg on McDanielAthletics.com.
Want to know more about the Centennial Conference? Log on to centennial.org, your one-stop source for news, scores, stories, and more on Centennial athletes and athletics. Our website has all the latest news and results from the championship. Have something to say? Follow us on Twitter. Like what you see? Recommend us on Facebook. That's the Centennial Conference online and on your mobile device for everything on this and every conference event.
Back way back in 1891 when these two teams met for the first time, Gettysburg got the biggest shutout in the all-time series. It came 98-0. Gettysburg wiped out McDaniel that day, but that was 1891, so let's keep that in mind. But they're about halfway. They're 40-0 here, midway through the third quarter here. It's been all Gettysburg. McDaniel's been shut out 19 times all time in the 67 previous meetings. And McDaniel's offense continues to struggle. And Gettysburg saved maybe one or two plays where they mis-executed there on that drive. The Bullets offense has been very, very solid today. The kickoff will land in the end zone. Tweedy will watch it over his shoulder, and it goes out the back end. And the Terror have the football at their 25-yard line after the touchback. In Centennial Conference play, which began in 1983, McDaniel has won 13. Gettysburg has won 18 times. So that's a little bit more of the recent history in this long-standing series. And here in Gettysburg, they've played 41 previous times. McDaniel has won 10 of them, but Gettysburg has won 30 of them. The lone tie in the series came here at Gettysburg. First and 10, McDaniel from their 25-yard line. Callahan's in trouble, grabbed by the jersey, slowed up, and brought down at the 20-yard line for a sack.
And the 40 points are the most that Bullets have posted in a game all year. And this is a Gettysburg offense that is probably hitting on all cylinders at the right time. 40 today. They had 31 last week at Susquehanna, 31 the week before against Juniata. That's good news when you're facing Muhlenberg and Johns Hopkins after the bye next week.
Callahan throws to Omelia on the far sideline. It's complete for a short pickup of about 4 or 5. And it is third and long for the Green Terror. Third and 10 from their 25. Again, quickly back up to the line. The sophomore has them set. Now he adjusts Chamberlain to his left. And he drops to throw. And a diving catch is made at the 30-yard line by Oliveto. When he secured it, he was flat on his back at the 30-yard line. That is a 5-yard pickup and a nice grab, but well shy of a first down. So McDaniel will have to boot the football away. But just a great effort by Oliveto here, a senior captain of the Green Terror. Caruso will await at his 40-yard line. Clock running, 6:35 to play in the third quarter. Here's Haas with a wobbler. It hits inside the Gettysburg 45-yard line and backs up into McDaniel territory, where it is covered up at the McDaniel 49-yard line. So for the second straight possession, Gettysburg will begin the drive in McDaniel territory. And their 5 scoring drives of the first half were all 2 minutes and 25 seconds or less off the game clock. They have been the definition of efficient. First and 10 Bullets. The handoff goes to Wigley. Wigley brought down, slashing off the right side at the 47-yard line. That'll be a 2-yard gain. And one of the Gettysburg linemen is shaken up.
This is a time where if you're Gettysburg, you're just trying to eat as much clock as possible. You'll go to the ground game. And your goal at this point pretty much just to make sure you come away healthy so that way you get some additional guys reps. And this also could be a time where if you're the Bullets, you're trying to stay mentally focused and look at some things where you could improve upon and try and use that as your focus for the second half, because it can be a little bit challenging when you've got a 40-0 lead. Try and stay mentally tough and focused. But my guess is this is the time where Barry Streeter can be a little bit harder on his club and look at things that they need to be working on and fix. And offensively, there's not a lot, but it's probably that type of time for the Bullets.
The injured player is Gettysburg senior Matt Gentile, one of the stars on their offensive line. Gentile, a 6'3", 270-pounder out of Glen Head, New York. And he waves off a couple of his teammates who wanted to assist him off the field, wearing a pair of knee braces, and he gingerly makes his way toward the Gettysburg sideline. And so Gentile will come to the bench, and as you were alluding to, his day may be done with a 40-0 lead. 6:01 shows on the third quarter clock here in Gettysburg, Pennsylvania.
Please reset to 611.
And 6:01 will turn into 611 as they add 10 seconds back on the game clock. 2nd and 9 as we resume play here from the McDaniel 47-yard line. The orange and blue-clad Bullets moving right to left in the second half here. And the pass is complete down the sideline to the 10, to the 5, diving for the pylon. And tucking it inside is Danny Christian, a wing back out of Reading, Pennsylvania. He just burst down the sideline, and Gettysburg goes 47 yards on a swing pass. A catch and run from Danny Christian, and Gettysburg is making a laugher with this one. Gettysburg's a man short. Andrew Major will hustle on to the special teams formation as Garrett Long will attempt to stay 100% perfect today on his PATs. Placement, kick, and it's good. 5:57 to go in the third quarter. It's Gettysburg 47. And McDaniel nothing here on McDanielAthletics.com.
Now open an all-new McDaniel Athletics online store. The new store features t-shirts, sweatshirts, polos, hats, shorts, sweatpants, anything you might want to support your favorite Green Terror team. Check it out online at shop.mcdanielathletics.com.
The Centennial Conference will be in their bye week next Saturday. Action resumes 2 Saturdays away, and you'll hear live coverage of Green Terror football here on McDanielAthletics.com as the Green Terror begin the second half of their season in Lancaster, taking on the Franklin and Marshall Diplomats. 1 o'clock kickoff, 12:35, the Green and Gold kickoff show begins right here on McDanielAthletics.com. Well, the Gettysburg Bullets, for more than 90 consecutive games, have been able to get points on the board. It is the longest such streak in the Centennial Conference. And in a big way, the Bullets have points on the board today. Akil Tweedy lets it hit near the goal line, and Garrett Long again booms a touchback. And the Terror will take it over at their 25-yard line, down 47-0, with just under 6 minutes to go in the third quarter.
And I think for a lot of guys in this Gettysburg team, because they are such a senior-laden roster, they're looking at, you're not looking ahead quite yet, but the 2 weeks after the bye week, you see Muhlenberg and Johns Hopkins. And for Gettysburg, you're thinking about payback, because last year they lost to the Mules 35-10. Johns Hopkins, they lost 34-16. And they want to get some payback because they're still very much in the mix for a Centennial title.
High snap, one-handed by Callahan, and Callahan is going to be snowed under. Nowhere to go. A bad snap back to him. It's all he could do to avoid a turnover there. And Callahan is thrown for a loss back to the 20-yard line. Make it the 22-yard line. They'll mark it for a 3-yard loss, 2nd and 13. Now here's a better snap back to Callahan, who throws a touch pass to the 25-yard line, up the sideline and out of bounds near the 35 is McDaniel's Bamasa Baylor, a freshman from Carlisle, Pennsylvania. And that'll be a first down for the Green Terror. The nose of the ball just at the 35-yard line. Gettysburg again cheating up near the line of scrimmage as Tayod Campbell crashes ahead off the left side across the 35 to the 36. It'll be a one-yard pickup.
LaBelle, not the only Carlisle native. You've got Matt Quattrone, also one of those guys, and his dad, Joel Quattrone, is the defensive coordinator for Dickinson, so that should make for a fun matchup in a couple of weeks.
Yeah, right you are. Second down and a long eight. Quick release this time from Callahan, and he finds O'Melia on the far side. And O'Melia's got it to the 43-yard line. Wrapped up, carried out of bounds after a gain of about six. So from the 42-yard line of McDaniel, they move left to right, looking for their first points of the day as the clock marches downward. 4:30 to play in the third quarter. 47-0 is the Green Terror deficit. Callahan backpedals, throws, finds an open man, Katowski, for a Green Terror first down. He is immediately cut down at the 47-yard line on a nice open field tackle, but JT Katowski's second catch of the day.
Charlie, have you ever noticed that when Katowski makes a catch, it's never an easy catch. He always has to reach behind or he's got guys right on top of him.
Callahan looks right, pulls it back down, runs in the middle of the field, and takes it into Gettysburg territory. I don't know if they're... He looked right and... I think he saw that they were going to jump the pattern and instead of delivering the ball, just decided to go up the middle with it. It didn't look to be designed that way. Gained six on the scramble and a second down and four. Gettysburg again jumping into the neutral zone and back out. And here's Campbell on a nice run. Powers his way off the right side, inside the 40, down to the 38-yard line. First down, Terror.
With the rush.
This drive began at the McDaniel 25-yard line. Callahan takes the shotgun snap, and he will be decked. It came hard and quickly, and McDaniel gives up another sack. And that time for Gettysburg looks like Joe Scaglione, a freshman defensive lineman out of New Jersey. And the loss is back. Gettysburg 46-yard line. That brings up second down and 18. Twin wide receivers each way for the Terror. Campbell in the backfield at running back. Callahan barking signals, takes the snap, play fake, throws a quick in, and sitting down after the catch at the 39-yard line is Nick O'Melia.
It was one of the outside linebackers for Gettysburg. And that pass, he jumped the route, and he guessed wrong. And so it kept a lane open, and so gain a seven.
And it's third and 11 for the Green Terror. Callahan drops to throw again. Throws complete at the 31-yard line, or was it ripped away? At the 31-yard line, officials comparing notes. The intended target was Oliveto. And the officials are going to discuss this. When Oliveto had hands on it, there's a Green Terror player shaken up. But before the tackle, the Bullets have stolen the football away, and it'll be the third turnover of the day against the Green Terror.
And they're going to say it was Vegso that came away with the interception. He jumped the route on the last pass, but there he was in the right spot and was able to come away with the interception, the second INT for the Bullets today.
And it appears to be Mike Oliveto, the Green Terror receiver who had initial hands on the ball, who was shaken up on the play, and they're attending to his right lower leg. And Oliveto experiencing some discomfort right now. Oliveto, a senior captain, 6 feet, 190 pounds from Pennsylvania. And Oliveto will be helped off the field and not putting any weight on that right leg. Gettysburg has taken the football away, stopping another Green Terror drive. The Green Terror have not been in the red zone yet today. And the Bullets have it back at their 31-yard line with 2:16 to go in the third quarter, leading at 47-0. New quarterback in the game for Gettysburg, and he hands off to Paul Lowry, a junior tailback from Midland Park, New Jersey. Lowry with a solid pickup on his first action today out to the 41-yard line and a first down.
And that might be the most frustrating drive of the game, Charlie, because you pick up three different first downs, and it looks like some momentum was starting to build, and then Vegso comes in, intercepts the ball, and suddenly Gettysburg has it back again.
Sam McDermott has taken over at quarterback for the Bullets, a junior from Newtown, Pennsylvania, 6 feet, 175. Wide man left is Samuel Schad. Pitch goes to the left. And a big hit put on Vincenzo Detrolio. Junior wingback turns the corner left side and gets bumped hard out of bounds on the near side of the field. The game seven, it'll be second down and three. They say that his forward progress was stopped in bounds, and they keep the clock going, now down to 1:20 to go in the third quarter. From the 47-yard line of Gettysburg, slot left formation. And the pitch goes up at the 48-yard line. It was intended for Gordon Prince, or beg your pardon, Derek Singer. And the pitch was a forward pitch, and they rule it an incomplete pass properly. We got a pretty good angle here from our vantage point, and it was essentially a shovel pass ahead. Went right to the turf, just a poorly executed toss. Fortunate for Gettysburg. Third down and three. Here's a toss into the short side of the field. Vincenzo Detrolio again on the carry. And he has stopped shy of a Gettysburg first down right at the midfield stripe. And with fourth down and one coming up, well, actually, they didn't give as much forward progress as I thought. They mark it down at the Gettysburg 48-yard line on the near side hash, and on fourth and three, Gettysburg will bring Robbie Fay and the punt unit out. And a new punt returner in the game for McDaniel, Sean Montgomery. Montgomery was shaken up earlier in the game, but he has returned since then, and he'll await the punt at the 15-yard line, shielding his eyes with the right hand, and a spiraling kick will hit at the 20-yard line. Now Montgomery will field on the first hop, get it ahead of the 24-yard line, and the penalty marker is fired in. Clock stop with 51 seconds to play in the third quarter as they discuss the penalty.
During your return, hold it. Number 27, receiving team. Penalized 10 yards from the spot of the foul. First down.
Well, the Green Terror have sustained their share of penalties today, and many of them on returns. And they'll go to work trailing 47-0 in the final seconds of the third quarter.
First and 10.
And the Green Terror making some substitutions here on offense, including a new running back in the game. Matty Callahan got his first start today. The sophomore remains in. The throw to Montgomery is complete at the 15-yard line. Short pass on the far side flat, and a gain of about five. Nick Bianco, a sophomore running back out of Montvale, New Jersey, is in the backfield, standing to Callahan's left on a second down and four play. And Bianco will get it, tripped up as he tries between the tackles, and will gain just a couple.
And Bianco's somebody that he got some playing time last week, and is somebody that Mike Hoyt said in pregame has stuck out in some of the JV games. So expect him to get into the rotation of Campbell and Chamberlain at that tailback position. And the three guys, all underclassmen, who are highlighting that tailback spot.
And the final seconds tick down. The third quarter comes to a conclusion. And Gettysburg enjoying a 47-0 lead over McDaniel here in Gettysburg, Pennsylvania, this Saturday afternoon, game 5 of the Centennial Conference season. 47-0 Bullets, and we'll continue with more of our live coverage here on McDanielAthletics.com.
I'm Kirsten Burks. I'm from Seattle, Washington. I play women's soccer, and I play in the midfield, and I am a senior. I chose McDaniel because of the small class size. Coming from the West Coast, we don't really have as much of that. And then when I came here and met the team and stuff, it all fit.
If you want to be a part of the vibrant McDaniel College community, schedule a visit and don't forget to apply early. Our early action deadlines of November 1st and December 1st are quickly approaching. Call the admissions office at 800-638-5005 to be connected to your personal admissions counselor. At McDaniel, you can expect the exceptional. Third and short play for McDaniel, and it will bring in the heavy package, which includes Ben Weber and Kevin Rosari. Slot right formation from the McDaniel 17-yard line. They now move right to left and miss the final frame. Gettysburg's outgained McDaniel 464 to 221 yards through three quarters of play. We'll have more stats for you in a moment. Now a third and short for McDaniel. High snap. Penalty marker is thrown as Bianco carries ahead. He's up to the 18-yard line and did not get enough for a first down. We'll sort out the penalty as well. Nick Bianco for just a 1-yard pickup.
Offside, defense, number 92, 5-yard penalty, previous spot, result, first down.
So Gettysburg finally penalized for offsides, and that advances the football 5 yards and gives the Green Tear a first down up at the 22-yard line. Bianco in at running back, trips to the right. Callahan stands in the pocket. Throws across the middle, a penalty marker thrown in the backfield as the pass is complete to Keith Woodrow. He's dropped immediately at the 23, so a gain of just a yard on the play, and again. Not sure if you could hear that clearly as the Gettysburg Bullets band joins in, but Gettysburg being flagged for contact below the knee of quarterback Matty Callahan. So a roughing the passer call advances the football 15 yards up to the 39-yard line of McDaniel, their second straight first down by penalty. First minute of play in the fourth quarter. 47-0, the McDaniel deficit, as Bianco is surrounded and stopped for no gain. Carried off the left side, and 3-4 different bullets appeared and held him for no gain to make it 2nd and 10. On the ground today, McDaniel just 46 net yards on 28 rushes through three quarters of play. Callahan airmails the pass over the head of Nick O'Melia. Reached out with the right hand and could not get a paw on it, and a penalty marker is dropped yet again. Gettysburg's rushed for 258 yards today. They've thrown for 206.
All right, 2 fouls on the play. Personal foul, roughing the passer, number 31 of the defense. Offense, chop block, those penalties offset, repeat, second down.
A minute into the fourth quarter.
Turn off your microphone.
It's been a problem all day.
It's almost like we're a three-man broadcasting booth today.
Second down and 10. And here's Callahan throwing incomplete. The ball on target, but Britton Hastings turned with it too quickly and drops a catchable pass Might have only been a short game, but it's an incomplete instead. Third down and 10. Montgomery wide to the left. Trips package to the right on third and 10. Callahan again takes a high, sluggish snap. Montgomery fights for the ball and makes the catch, and he's gone. Touchdown, McDaniel. 61 yards. Big play from Sean Montgomery. The coverage was very good. The touch on the pass was very good, but the play on the back end by Montgomery was outstanding.
And he really had to fight to get that football, but he managed to buck the defender and take it all the way to the house. That was another one of those hard-earned catches for the Green Terror today, and finally they get on the board.
Spencer Wiersberg, where you been? He's on to attempt the extra point. It's been a long time coming for the Green Terror today. Wiersberg puts it up and through. And the Green Terror are on the board this afternoon with 13:48 to go in the fourth quarter on a 61-yard connection from Matty Callahan to senior Sean Montgomery, 47-7. The Green Terror trail the Bullets this afternoon in Gettysburg, Pennsylvania.
Now open an all-new McDaniel Athletics online store. The new store features t-shirts, sweatshirts, polos, hats, shorts, sweatpants, anything you might want to support your favorite Green Terror team. Check it out online at shop.mcdanielathletics.com.
A reminder that homecoming is coming up on October 25th. Plan now to return to the Hill for a 1 o'clock kickoff as the Green Terror host Dickinson. Come early for the parade, stay for the reunions, and much, much more. Homecoming at Hill Stadium, Saturday, October 25th.
By the way, Charlie, with that touchdown catch by Montgomery that went 61 yards, he has nearly equaled his career high for receiving yards in a game. He had 69 earlier this year against Moravian.
So one big play results in points for McDaniel. Callahan with a very nice touch on the pass that time. And the Green Terror kickoff for the first time since the opening kickoff of the game, when they sustained a delay of game penalty. And on the return, Nick Ulassen gets out to the 10-yard line, gets dropped at that spot, a return of 8 yards. And Gettysburg will start from what I think is their worst field position of the day, their own 11-yard line.
And that's back-to-back positives for McDaniel. You get that great play by Montgomery, and then you also get a Keel Tweedy coming up on the kickoff and taking down Ulassen at the 10-yard line. He's been a shifty guy who's been tough to bring down.
Sam McDermott remains in at quarterback for the Bullets, who go to the running game, and the Green Terror rises up on defense and shut that down for no gain at the 11-yard line. The ball carrier, DeTrolio, second and 10. Substitution now for the Bullets as they do huddle up here. Play clock down to 13. A 40-point Bullets lead. And a little bit of confusion there as DeTrolio will have to adjust to the far side of the formation. McDermott delivers the ball in the flat. It is complete up at the 15-yard line. He finds Danny Christian, a three-year letter winner. And Christian had a touchdown in the third quarter. The gain here is about 4, making it third down and 6. Christian's touchdown was a catch and run, which covered 47 yards. One of 2 Bullet scores in the third quarter. Garrett Long also had a 24-yard field goal with 8:02 to play. And that field goal drive was 2:29, so that, again, was the longest Gettysburg drive in terms of time off the clock in the ball game. Here's a deep throw to the far flank and a nice diving effort, but an unsuccessful one by Gettysburg's Derek Singer. Good coverage underneath by the Green Terror, and on fourth and six, Terror defense is forced to three and out.
A good job by McDaniel right from the start, getting that originally on that kickoff. A great play by Tweed and getting a couple of stops against the run. And there for McDermott, it's very difficult to try and roll out against your body and make a good throw.
The Terror were a man short. Montgomery awaits at the 50-yard line, and then he'll back away from a ground ball kick, which hops deeper into McDaniel territory and dies at the 40-yard line. So the Green Terror, the substitution difficulties continue for them today. They were a man short. And the Terror have turned the field here a little bit. They'll start at their 40-yard line with 11:56 to go in the game. Johns Hopkins has defeated Juniata today to remain perfect on the season. We'll check other Centennial Conference scores for you momentarily. Here comes McDaniel with 11:56 to play in the ballgame. Down 47-6. Callahan fakes it to Campbell. Looks to his left and throws to no one. Too tall for Keith Woodrow. Woodrow either broke off his route or Callahan expected him to be somewhere else. Either way, they weren't on the same page. And it's an incomplete pass, second and 10. From the 40-yard line, McDaniel moving right to left. Trips to the left. Callahan, a long count. Hand off Campbell, lowers the shoulder and powers out to about the 44-yard line. Initial contact came at the line of scrimmage, so Campbell was able to surge ahead for additional yardage. They put it down at the 45. That's a 4-yard, 5-yard gain. Third and five. Trips left formation, the wide side of the field. Callahan, short drop, delivers the ball to the 20-yard line, incomplete. Nick O'Melia, the intended target, but Joe Raba running step for step with him. Oh, beg your pardon. Ty Abdul-Karim, a freshman out of D.C. for the Bullets with a good coverage. Fourth and five, and quickly, the Green Terror about to turn the football back over.
13, Brad Huff, 236,
Caruso awaits near his 15-yard line. A high spiraling kick will hit out of bounds near the Gettysburg 20-yard line. So first down, Gettysburg at that spot. And now 11:09 to go. The Hopkins win over Juniata, 56-14. 5 minutes to go in the fourth quarter at Ursinus, where the Bears are shutting out Moravian 24-0. Muhlenberg leading Susquehanna, but just 24-17 with 6:43 to play in that ball game. The Mules have only one loss. Susquehanna is yet to taste victory this season. On a first down play, the toss back goes to Gettysburg wingback Derek Singer, who brings it out to the 24-yard line for a 4-yard pickup. And also today, they're about to begin the fourth quarter in Carlisle, where Dickinson and Franklin and Marshall battle for the Conestoga Wagon Trophy. Dickinson up by 6, 20-14, entering the fourth quarter in Carlisle this afternoon. Second and six. Shotgun snap back to McDermott. And McDermott hands it off to Paul Lowry, a junior. Lowry forces his way laterally along the line of scrimmage, but aims nothing.
Meanwhile, Charlie, it's been a tough day for Maryland. They're playing 20th-ranked Ohio State. The game has just gone final. The Buckeyes pull a 52-24 win today. And then in the top 25, upset brewing, Ole Miss and Texas A&M, and all hotty toddy today. The Rebels a 48-17 lead on the Aggies with 6:10 remaining in the game. So Ole Miss flexing their muscles.
Yeah, that was about done, huh? Third down and six. Scrambling to his right is McDermott. Now he reverses field and will pick up a first down. Up to the 40, out of bounds at the 42-yard line. The whole flow of the play went to the right. And as the field opened up, McDermott saw that. And either it was designed or he just had great field vision there, but plenty of room to operate, easily picking up the first down and more. As he brings the ball out to the Gettysburg 42-yard line, first down, Bullets.
And McDermott, just like Miller in that respect, if he doesn't see that option on the pass, he's just going to tuck it and run. And there he was able to get a nice gainer out of it, 18 yards.
Really lead the Crusaders.
Bullets go to the ground and take it out to the 43-yard line. Gain of about two. Second down and eight. Clock showing 8:43 and on the move in the fourth quarter, 47-7. Gettysburg has not trailed in the game, scored on their first possession. Toss goes to the left. And Paul Lowry will take a hit, break free, and be brought down at the 50-yard line. That's a 6-yard pickup. Checking into the game for the Bullets, Danny Christian, a wingback. As Samuel Shod, a wide receiver, gives way. Third down and two. The nose of the football right on the 50. McDermott hands it off and diving ahead to the 48-yard line of McDaniel. Looks like Lowry has picked up a Bullets first down. Gettysburg with 636 yards of offense at Westminster last year. In a 50-28 victory, 464 after three quarters of play today. And Gettysburg has penetrated into McDaniel territory. First down. And Lowry gets clogged up behind the line this time. They drag him down from behind, hold him for no gain.
Now this would mark the second time in as many years that Gettysburg would be able to put up 50 points against McDaniel. They only put 50 points one time last season. So right now they got that 47-7 lead.
Freshman Josh Herman was there to make the tackle for McDaniel on that last play. About a half a yard pickup, second and nine. Toss goes to Lowry, has some blockers in front. Cuts inside, wrestled to the ground at the 45-yard line. McDaniel's Richard Settle, a freshman from Dillsburg, Pennsylvania, holds him to a short gain of about three. Third down and seven. Bullets keeping the clock moving. Shod checks out. Joe Rava, a wide receiver, comes into the offensive set for the Bullets. With junior quarterback Sam McDermott calling the signals. McDermott steps up in the pocket. It's incomplete, and a penalty marker is thrown. The pass was intended for Vincenzo Detrolio, and he got dragged down from behind. And an easy call. Or maybe not so easy, because they're spending an awful lot of time figuring it out. All right, so it's going to be against McDaniel. They just wanted to – determine where to position the ball.
Defense, number 36, 15-yard penalty from the previous spot. Automatic, first down.
That advances the ball to the McDaniel 30-yard line. It'll be a long bye week for the Green Terror, who have not performed in the manner that they had hoped today here on the road. And the swing pass is behind Derek Singer, I should say. And Singer spun to the ball but could not yank it down. It goes for an incompletion, and it's second down and 10.
And after three challenging weeks, you deserve a chance to regroup, especially with such a young team. And so it's a time where everybody can get a little bit of a break, and you can kind of look at what you've done this season and then try and make some adjustments. So hopefully the second half of the year will be a little bit better, a little bit easier.
Zach Miller throws for 206 yards today. He's given way to Sam McDermott. McDermott with the toss back, and he gets it to Lowry. Lowry running into the short side of the field and gets stopped at the 29-yard line of McDaniel. 1 yard on the pickup, third down and 9. Stay with us in the postgame show. A complete statistical wrap-up of this one is forthcoming, and we'll check if there are any other finals in the Centennial Conference action in this week number 5 of the season. Shotgun snap, ball sent ahead, and McDaniel falls on it. Let's see if they rule it an incomplete pass, and indeed they will. They say it's a shovel pass, and McDermott, just a dangerous play right there. He knew he was going to get smacked and tried to complete the pitch play, and lucky for the Bullets, the ball had a little bit of forward momentum there because it just dropped on the turf like a poached egg, and McDaniel had two players surrounded, but it's incomplete. Fourth down and 9. The Bullets keep the offense out here. Clock at 5:13. Twin wide receivers each way. McDermott eludes the first man, goes over the middle and misses his target. He was looking to go to Singer. Singer was wide open, but McDermott got a little bit ahead of himself there, and he sends it wide of Singer. The Green Terror defense forced a turnover on downs, and they will take over the football at the 29-yard line.
Tell you what, y'all, it's a fun week in top 25 football this week. You got Florida State will play Wake Forest, but Ole Miss and Alabama, I think I mentioned earlier, Mississippi and Texas A&M, Mississippi State and Texas A&M, 48-24, Bulldogs with the lead, 2:29 left.
They fake the handoff to Bianco. The swing pass gains yardage out to the 39-yard line, I should say, as Marty Windisch, the junior out of Manchester Valley High School, picks up a first down for the Terror to the 40-yard line. An 11-yard gain. Double slot formation. Callahan fakes the handoff, swings it to Katowski, and Katowski juggles, retains, and gets it back to the line of scrimmage.
We've got TCU and Oklahoma playing. Remember, the Horned Frogs, the last time they played Oklahoma, they came away with a win. You've got Stanford and Notre Dame, the Cardinal 14, the Irish, the ninth-ranked team in the country. So, this is a fun day. Then you got 15th-ranked LSU and number 5 Auburn. A fun day for college football.
Callahan finds Omelia. He tiptoes along the sideline and gets to the 47-yard line of McDaniel for a 7-yard gain. That's Omelia's 8th catch of the day. But only for... That matches his long reception of the day, 7 yards. Callahan in trouble, and he'll be sacked at the 42-yard line. The protection broke down quickly that time, and Callahan is dropped at the 42, a 5-yard loss. And today Callahan has been sacked four times. Fourth down and 8 Green Terror from their 42-yard line. Let's see what they have in the offensive playbook here. Trips left. Bianco is the running back. Long count. Callahan drops to throw, finds Bianco in the middle of the field. Bianco leans to the 50-yard line. It's going to be close. Second effort by Bianco. He refused to go down. A little crossing pattern. And a first down is signaled as the Terror pick it up on a 4th and 8 play. Windish in the slot left. Bamasa Baylor wide to the left. Callahan gives it to Bianco, slanting off the left side on a counter play. And no one fooled for Gettysburg that time. Wyatt Yasinski, junior defensive end out of Palmyra, Pennsylvania, held McDaniel for no gain. Now Chamberlain in the game at running back. Trips right formation with 2:32 to go. Callahan gives it to Chamberlain. Chamberlain one-on-one out in the flat. Chamberlain gets out of bounds in Gettysburg territory at the 42-yard line. About 2 yards shy of a McDaniel first down. Clock stop, 2:25 to play. Next up for Gettysburg, they're at Muhlenberg in 2 weeks, and then Johns Hopkins in 3 weeks. A challenging part of their schedule is ahead. Callahan overthrows Baylor, and it is picked off by Gettysburg. Up the sideline. Gets a block. Now in McDaniel territory and grabbed from behind. Bianco brought him down at the 39-yard line. The pass is picked off by Lou Ramos. And Callahan overthrew his target that time and paid the penalty. There are a couple of penalty markers down. Looks like this is going to be on the return, however.
That's going to change the possession. And we can block it back on a return. Number 46, defense, 10-yard penalty from the start of the foul. First down.
Tim Gill called for a block in the back, and that'll bring it all the way back to the Gettysburg 25-yard line. But it is the fourth turnover of the day against McDaniel. They're now -4 on the season, and the Bullets came in at a -2, but they have taken it away four times in this ballgame.
And that instance, Callahan had the matchup that he wanted, but he overthrew his man. And most of the time when he's been picked off, it's because he's underthrown his guy, but they're well too far out in front of his receiver.
Gettysburg first and 10 from their 25-yard line with a commanding 47-7 lead. And they put it on the ground. Not much there. Landing off the left side was Lowry. And Lowry picks up a yard. Clock at 1:40 to play. This should be the final possession of the game, barring a turnover by the Bullets. McDaniel does have all 3 timeouts, of course, but down by 40. Sportsmanship calls for just playing out the string. Lowry again, same play off the left side. This time he gains 2 out to the 28. And we've got 70 seconds remaining in this one. The 68th meeting all time is going to go Gettysburg's way, and it started right on the first possession of the game when the Bullets marched 62 yards in 8 plays. And Fred Caruso got the scoring going on a 19-yard touchdown catch out of the backfield. Lowry starts left, cuts back right, and gains a Gettysburg first down. Tripped up by Tweedy. He makes the knockdown at the 37-yard line. Make it the 38.
This will be the Bullets' 4th straight win over McDaniel and another decisive victory. The 49th overall for Gettysburg in this
this all-time series, and they've got some good momentum going. You know, they're two upcoming games with two of the toughest teams in the conference in both Johns Hopkins and Muhlenberg.
The game clock and the play clock nearly synchronized here. The Bullets will have to snap it one more time. They do so. Lowry works his way ahead. Carries beyond the 45 to the 46-yard line on the final play of the game. That will do it. Gettysburg picks up their third consecutive victory this season. Trailing the game. The first possession down the field, 62 yards. And built up a sizable halftime lead. And McDaniel has bought their fourth in a row. McDaniel now 1-4. And they are 0-4 in conference play. While Gettysburg goes to 3-2, and the Bullets are now 3-1. Finally today at Musselman Stadium. The Gettysburg Bullets 47 and the McDaniel Green Terror 7. Stay with us. Our post-game show follows next on McDanielAthletics.com.
Do you know what the McDaniel College community calls the youngest person ever to argue before the Supreme Court? A news anchor, TV host, a wildlife conservationist, cutting-edge biomedical researcher, video game designer, Hollywood producer, best-selling author, and winners of an Emmy and a Pulitzer Prize? We call them alumni. No wonder our alumni achieve greatness. A top-tier liberal arts college that changes lives, McDaniel College offers each student a customized and personal liberal arts education supported by faculty-staff collaboration with leadership and service opportunities. McDaniel is the best bang for the buck, according to Washington Monthly, and recognized as the best value by Kiplinger's Personal Finance. Come see for yourself. Check out Mick Live, our online calendar, at McDaniel.edu for upcoming events, performances, exhibitions, lectures, and more that are free and open to the public. Again, to learn more, visit McDaniel.edu or call 410-857-2230 to schedule a campus visit.
We welcome you back to Gettysburg on McDanielAthletics.com. Tough day for the Green Terror all around. They fell behind early, 7-0, on a Fred Caruso 19-yard touchdown reception. Zach Miller with one of two touchdown throws today. Miller, the quarterback, also had two touchdown rushes, and we'll take a complete look at the statistics in a moment. But Gettysburg led this one 12:35 to play in the first quarter and built a halftime advantage of 37-0 and going on to a 47-7 victory today over the McDaniel Green Terror. And, the lasting image of this one for me is that McDaniel, I think, had a game plan. They had an approach. They knew their opponent pretty well. And there was just a little bit of sloppiness, some missed opportunities, definitely some penalty problems today. Just not the kind of performance that they were looking for. A loss is a loss, but not the kind of a performance they were looking for heading into the bye week. It almost feels like a step backward today.
It really does. And you come into this week, and you're facing a Gettysburg team. You know how talented they are, and they are a little bit different from your Sinus team. And the speed at which their offense was moving, it was definitely a change from a pro-style offense that you saw last week, where it was a little more traditional from your Sinus. And in the first quarter, you saw some encouraging signs. They were 2-for-4 on third down. They weren't able to get inside the red zone, but you could tell that Callahan, it looked pretty good from the start, even though Gettysburg got that 14-0 lead. And in the second quarter, that's where I really think that step back started to take place. The Gettysburg 23 points, and the speed at which they were able to get these scores, with all of them lasting 2.5 minutes or less in that first half, just shows just how quick they were able to move. McDaniel was having trouble getting the right personnel on the field, and that second quarter ultimately was the killer.
The ground game of Gettysburg today was impressive, the pace at which they run their offense, and Zach Miller engineered a multifaceted kind of offensive attack today. So McDaniel's defense rose to the occasion on occasion, but Gettysburg had a lot of options there, including a number of running backs, and Zach Miller himself, who ran for two touchdowns, and he made some pretty good decisions, I think.
He made some great decisions and was very accurate in the passing game and used a number of different receivers. You know, there wasn't just one guy, and the running offense was also multifaceted for the Bullets. And when you've got that many different weapons, can employ some different looks and can move at a quick pace, it can be very difficult to defend.
As we look at the McDaniel defensive performance today, and again, we'll have final stats in a bit, Drew Scott, the freshman linebacker, through three quarters of play, had six tackles plus seven assists for a total of 13 tackles on the day. The Green Terror didn't take the football away today, but Scott and Brandon Jones and even Dan Traynor showed up in the secondary somewhat today. Eddie Kendall also had a nice game defensively for the Green Terror. So there's certainly talent on the both sides of the football for McDaniel. They're just looking to find the execution that's necessary to stand toe for toe here with quality opposition in the Centennial Conference. And it wasn't there today, fell behind early, and that forced them to kind of abandon the game plan, which was going to emphasize the rushing attack a little bit. They've got to establish the run. They're known as a passing attack, came into play today, leading the conference in passing yardage. But you just can't live and die with that. If you're not scoring, you can, you know, amass all the yardage you want, but you got to get it in the end zone. The Green Terror weren't doing that early enough, and so not keeping defenses honest. So they had the game plan, but they fell behind again today, and that caused some adjustments, I think, that ultimately led to, you know, some gambling, which played into Gettysburg's hands, because Gettysburg was able to take advantage of a couple of short fields in that second half. They had scoring drives of 33 and 48 yards in the third quarter, which removed all doubt in this ball game. And they go into a 47-7 victory here on their home field to get to 3-2, and a very good 3-1 in the Centennial Conference, with their two most challenging games probably ahead in the next two games.
It's good that both teams are going into the bye for a different reason. For McDaniel, it's a time to evaluate and to clean some things up and make some adjustments, and also to continue to teach for Mike Hoyt. You know, you look at how young this team is, and then for Gettysburg, it's really a time to rest and a time to prepare, because it's very difficult when you have to go play Muhlenberg and Hopkins in back-to-back weeks. The tough stretch for McDaniel is over, and they really saw some challenging opponents. And, you know, youth is something that, you know, McDaniel is going to battle all season, and it's something that in a couple of years they'll look at all the stuff that they were able to learn. This could be a very good football team when you have lots of freshmen and sophomores that you're playing. It's very difficult to make in-game adjustments and to make snap-by-snap adjustments like you want to. And with Gettysburg being so senior-laden and having so many guys on this team that have seen considerable playing time in previous years, it makes it difficult for a McDaniel team that offensively what they have to do, it has to be very simple. And a lot of times when they're seeing different looks out of Gettysburg, they're bouncing around and they're making different changes to their looks pre-snap to try and adjust. And also, you've got to keep things pretty static. And that's just one of those learning curves that you're going to go through when you've got a young ball club.
And so it adds up to a Gettysburg 47-7 victory over McDaniel this Saturday afternoon in Gettysburg. And we will continue with more of our post-game show from Shirk Field at Musselman Stadium right here on McDanielAthletics.com.
Do you know what the McDaniel College community calls the youngest person ever to argue before the Supreme Court? A news anchor and TV host? A wildlife conservationist? Cutting-edge biomedical researcher, video game designer, Hollywood producer, best-selling author, and winners of an Emmy and a Pulitzer Prize? We call them alumni. No wonder our alumni achieve greatness. A top-tier liberal arts college that changes lives, McDaniel College offers each student a customized and personal liberal arts education supported by faculty-staff collaboration with leadership and service opportunities. McDaniel is a best bang for the buck, according to Washington Monthly, and recognized as a best value by Kiplinger's Personal Finance. Come see for yourself. Check out Mick Live, our online calendar, at McDaniel.edu for upcoming events, performances, exhibitions, lectures, and more that are free and open to the public. Again, to learn more, visit McDaniel.edu or call 410-857-2230 to schedule a campus visit.
Ryan Mahoney, senior linebacker, long snapper, football from Long Island, New York. My older sister graduated from here, so once she came here and I visited, I just fell in love.
And if you want to be a part of the vibrant McDaniel College community, all you have to do is schedule a visit, and don't forget to apply early. The early action deadline is November 1st and December 1st. They are quickly approaching, so please call the admissions office right away at 800-638-5005, and you'll be connected to a personal admissions counselor at McDaniel. You can expect the exceptional. Charlie Beckhart, together with Jeff Arnold, on McDanielAthletics.com following Gettysburg's 47-7 defeat of McDaniel this Saturday afternoon. A look at some of the numbers of the ball game now. Gettysburg outgains the Green Terror 527-318, including 320-46 on the ground. The Green Terror managed 272 yards through the air today, the fifth straight game that McDaniel has gone over 200 yards. Gettysburg went over 200 as well, with 207 yards. The Green Terror penalized 10 times for 70 yards. Gettysburg penalized a total of 9 times, also for 70 yards. The Bullets put together 24 first downs today, while the Green Terror managed just 15. On third down, the Bullets were 7 of 17. McDaniel just 4 of 17. And on fourth down today, McDaniel was 1 of 2, and Gettysburg was 1 of 3. The Green Terror did not get to the red zone today, and Gettysburg was 5 of 5 in all of their red zone opportunities today. A big number, 4 turnovers for the Green Terror, and they come in a number of different ways, including 2 interceptions, and the Bullets did not turn the football over today. They did score 7 points off of the McDaniel turnover. So the Green Terror with a fumble and 2 interceptions today, and Gettysburg sacked McDaniel quarterback Matty Callahan 4 times today and had 11 tackles for loss overall, while McDaniel had 4 tackles for loss. Leading the way for the Green Terror ground game, Taya Campbell, and leading the way is a bit of a misnomer in that he had just 31 yards on 12 carries, but it tells you how difficult it was. The sledding tough on the ground today for McDaniel, who managed just the 46 yards on 32 carries, an average of 1.4 yards per carry for the entire team. The longest run of the day was 9 yards for McDaniel. John Chamberlain carried 6 times for 20 yards, averaging 3.3 yards. Through the air, Callahan, 27 of 40 for 272 yards. He threw a touchdown pass to Sean Montgomery that covered 61 yards. But Callahan was picked off 3 times today. Montgomery, 2 catches for 68 yards and the touchdown reception. Mike Oliveto had 4 catches for 60 yards. And Nick O'Melia came up with 8 catches today for 48 yards. 3 catches apiece for Chamberlain and JT Katowski. Windisch had 2. Keith Woodrow had 3 catches for McDaniel. 27 receptions, 272 yards today for the Terror, who averaged 10.1 yards per reception. Zach Miller had a big day, a quarterback for the Bullets, 9 of 16 for 206 yards, a 12.9 yards per attempt average. He threw 3 touchdowns. He hit Fred Caruso, Jordan Kelso, and Danny Christian with touchdowns today. He rushed for 2 more on 9 carries. He had 75 yards to lead the Bullets on the ground, an 8.3 yard average. Nick Ulassen had 13 carries for 56 yards and a touchdown. Kyle Wigley, 12 carries, 53 yards. Paul Lowry, 13 carries for 50 yards today for the Bullets, who had 4 different players carry for 50 yards or more today. They averaged 5.3 yards every time they touched the ball on the ground and had 3 rushing touchdowns. Fred Caruso, 95 receiving yards on 3 catches. including the first touchdown of the game. That came from 19 yards out. Jordan Kelso, two catches and a touchdown. He covered 57 yards. Danny Christian, two catches and a touchdown, 51 yards. Kevin McCarthy, Travis Andrews, Nick Ulassen, and Derek Singer all had catches today for the Bullets. See if we can hunt up some defensive statistics here really quick. And none of them are forthcoming. And so we will remind you that Gettysburg, with another solid offensive performance, following up a 636-yard total offense performance last year, gained 527 today, more than enough, in a 47-7 victory over the McDaniel Green Terror. Now, we want to remind you that there are a lot of events coming up athletically for McDaniel teams, despite the fact that the football team is going into the bye week. Plenty of Green Terror sports will get you through the next 2 weeks, including the women's soccer team playing a pair of key road conference games at Dickinson on Wednesday at 4:30, then at Franklin and Marshall on Wednesday the 15th at 7 o'clock. The field hockey team continues its stretch against top 20 teams, hosting Dickinson on Wednesday at 4:30 before traveling to Lebanon Valley the following Tuesday at 5 o'clock. Men's soccer, the only team in Westminster next Saturday, hosting the Diplomats of F&M at 3 o'clock. They follow that up with their final non-conference game of the season at Hood on Tuesday the 14th at 4 o'clock. The volleyball team takes to the road, traveling to Dickinson, Swarthmore, and Franklin to Marshall over the next 10 days. That's what's going on, and you can stay up to date at McDanielAthletics.com and also through social media, Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. We'll take our final break, come back to check the other Centennial Conference scorers of the day, and wrap things up from Gettysburg, where the Bullets have defeated the Green Terror by a score of 47-7, and we'll return on McDanielAthletics.com right after this.
Want to know more about the Centennial Conference? Log on to Centennial.org, your one-stop source for news, scores, stories, and more on Centennial athletes and athletics. Our website has all the latest news and results from the championship. Have something to say? Follow us on Twitter. Like what you see? Recommend us on Facebook. That's the Centennial Conference online and on your mobile device for everything on this and every conference event.
Well, Jeff's hunted down the defensive statistics that I was looking for earlier, and I was actually checking to see, you know, Drew Scott had 13 tackles through three quarters of play. I was looking to see if he padded that any, and the answer is he did not. He had a pass breakup today and 13 tackles on the game. Jake Fernandez contributed 8 tackles. Eddie Kendall, a nice performance with 7 tackles for the Green Terror defense, and Brandon Jones and Hunter Metcalf each had 5 tackles today. Tackles for loss from Nick Marino, Zach Collette, and a half a tackle for loss each for Metcalf and Andy Ullman. Leading the way for the Gettysburg defensive effort this afternoon was Mike McGuire, who had 11 tackles in all, 7 from Brian Calatozo, 6 each from me, Pinella, and Joseph Begso. Pinella had the safety for Gettysburg, which turned the tide of this game as Gettysburg goes on to a 47-7 win here over the Green Terror. Johns Hopkins, the number 10 team in the nation, remains perfect as they defeat Juniata today handily at Homewood Field in Baltimore, final count 56-14. Hopkins defeating Juniata for the 8th time in 9 meetings and now 8 times in a row. So Johns Hopkins on the year 5-0 and leading the Centennial Conference at 4-0 overall. Juniata drops to 2-3 and 1-3 in the Centennial. Ursinus shut out Moravian today by a score of 24-0. Moravian falling to 3-2, 2-2 in the Centennial. Ursinus remains tied with Hopkins atop the Centennial standings with a 4-0 conference mark, and they are perfect at 5-0, Ursinus defeating the Greyhounds for the 4th straight year. Muhlenberg holds off Susquehanna by a 24-20 count today. The Mules get to 4-1, 3-1 in the Centennial, staying in the chase. Susquehanna remains winless at 0-5, 0-4 in the Centennial Conference. And it is gone final in Carlisle, where Dickinson has defeated Franklin and Marshall by a score of 27-14. And they capture the Conestoga Wagon Trophy, the 104th meeting between these two squads. Franklin and Marshall falling to 2-3, 1-3 in the Centennial, while Dickinson is now 2-3 as well, and 2-2 in Centennial Conference play. McDaniel falling today by a score of 47-7 at the hands of the Gettysburg Bullets, and after a week off, the Green Terror hitting the road in 2 weeks. They go to Lancaster, taking on the F&M Diplomats, and still not too late to get the tide turned a little bit here and make something of this season. They've lost four in a row, but again, coming into play today, we recognize that McDaniel had faced opposition, which had combined for a 12-3 record through the first four, 5 weeks of the season. So McDaniel's faced some tough opposition, an opportunity to see what they're made of character-wise here. And the bye week probably comes at a good time in terms of resetting what they're trying to do here in the program during this 2014 season, which began with such an uplifting victory and now has fallen on hard times over the last 4 weeks.
You're naturally going to get tired over the first 5 weeks of the season where you're facing a number of really difficult teams, or I should say the first 4 weeks of the season. You're going to face teams like Muhlenberg or Sinus and Gettysburg. Naturally, it's going to be exhausting because just the different styles that they play, and for a team especially like in our Sinus and a Gettysburg, just how veteran a club that they actually are. But it's also really a learning experience for a team like this. You go from Muhlenberg or Sinus, Gettysburg, there's really not any type of a letdown in those three types of weeks. And granted, Dickinson and Susquehanna and Juniata, as well as Franklin and Marshall, they all present their own individual challenges. But it gives you a chance to breathe. It gives you an opportunity to look at what needs to be fixed, focus on what really needs to get cleaned up. You have to try and find you have to do a little bit better on third down. And you also need to get a little bit more consistency in that running game. And I think the extra week will be good, too, because McDaniel trying to show a little bit more of its option off now that they've pretty much gone to Matty Callahan to run this offense. The sophomore, it'll give him more of a chance to get comfortable, get reps that he needs. And you could see that there are times where he was connecting with his receivers, but there's still that adjustment period where he wasn't getting the reps that McFall was the first couple of weeks. So there's that time where he'll need to continue to get down the routes that everybody's running, how quickly everybody moves, and just the little particulars that really make you a good quarterback. And also it'll allow for some additional time to install maybe a little bit more of an option game for this McDaniel team with Callahan at the helm, and it'll allow the offensive line to get things in touch as well. But you knew this was going to be a challenging stretch these first few weeks with the type of clubs that you're going to face, and the Centennial's a good football league, and this additional week is, as you talked about, much needed, and one where it should be another a week, even though there are no games, a learning week.
And so Gettysburg gets above the 500 mark for the first time this season, right at the halfway point, and they will prepare for difficult road games coming up after the bye. They'll be at Muhlenberg and then at Johns Hopkins, and the Green Terror will take a week off and hit the road in 2 weeks with a trip to Lancaster, taking on the Diplomats of Franklin and Marshall. Jeff Arnold will be joined by John Seaman. Two Saturdays away, they'll have all the action for you. McDaniel and F&M, 1 o'clock kickoff from Spinagle Williamson Field. If you can't make it there, we'll hit the air with a Green and Gold kickoff show right here, 12:35, with an audio broadcast on McDanielAthletics.com. We want to extend our thanks to Braden Snyder and Corey Jewett of the Gettysburg Sports Information Office, and also to Luke Stilson, the McDaniel Sports Information Director, for all of their help in making today's broadcast possible. I also want to thank Green Terror Head Coach Mike Hoyt for spending some time with us on the pregame show, and to senior captain and victorious cross-country runner Avalon McCumber, who spent some time with us at halftime. Production assistance today from Tim Murray. And now for Jeff Arnold, this is Charlie Beckhardt, thanking you for joining us and reminding you that our next Green Terror broadcast is coming up in 2 weeks from F&M, the Green Terror and the Diplomats, right here beginning at 12:35 on McDanielAthletics.com. One final time from Gettysburg, Pennsylvania, and Shirk Field at Musselman Stadium. Our final today in Centennial Conference football action, the Gettysburg Bullets 47 and the McDaniel Green Terror 7. Thanks for being with us, everybody. We will see you next time.